Hi, this is Gautam, Geography Faculty, Shankaray's Academy, and we'll be starting the discussion for geography questions. So totally we have 8 to 9 questions. I call it 8 to 9 because you can treat two questions as, you know, you cannot treat two questions as strictly geographical or sociological. There is a combination of answers which you can provide, right? So I'll read out the question, both for 10 markers and 15 markers, then I will progress. Before I start the discussion for geography questions, I would like to make one thing clear. See, point is, the objective of the discussion is to tell you how to approach the answer on spot. It's not like, you know, it's not about referring 10 or 15 textbooks and then simply narrating points. No. Let's say you're in the examination hall, you look at the question paper, you just want to frame your thought process, for example, 30 seconds to 60 seconds, and then how exactly you structure the answer, then you present your points. Okay, so that's the first part. And second thing is, what are the common mistakes or the narrow-mindedness which a candidate might have when he's answering the UPSC question? So these are the two factors which we're going to discuss. Because factual information, you will directly get from internet. Okay, there is no point in discussing about things which are already there. But you find a question on spot, how exactly do you tackle it in the restricted time with the pressure of the examination hall? So all the questions will be dealt with in that particular spirit. So let me start with question number 4 in General Studies paper 1. This is a 10 marker. So the question says, we look at the keywords alone, differentiate causes of landslides in Himalayan region, and then your Western Ghats. Right. Always remember the thumb rule when you write your mains answers. It's always required or requested that when you present your introduction part, the introduction part has some sort of data. Like if I'm discussing for a GS paper 2, for example, I would recommend that you write an article number which is relevant to the question. Now, this is a geography question. I would definitely request you in the introduction to mention, the question says, what exactly are differentiate between landslides? So you can start the introduction with what landslides are, the definition of landslides, then possibly a map of India. Okay. Not a very detailed one, but just a basic one to indicate areas in which you experience landslides. For example, mostly the northeastern region, the mountainous terrain, leaving out Assam and then the western Himalayan region, then parts of Western Ghats, right? This serves as the introduction. You know, approximately 22 to 25% of land area in India can be said as, you know, very high risk to moderate risk to landslides. That is expected to be the introduction. Once this is done, you look at the question, you would think that you're not able to generate points. But you can generate points very easily if you start with the fundamental thought process. Always remember, any question in geography, deal with it in terms of both physical and human factors. If you can write both of them, that is physiographical factors, then your human factors, then the answer is mostly done. There is nothing to worry about. Pay attention here. Naturally, when you look at both, the question says causes. You're not worried about consequences at all. So cause of Himalayan region and Western Ghats, the most immediate thoughts which come in your mind is about the physical geography because it says landslides. So let's start with them. First, talk about the rock structure. Okay, Western Ghats is very, very old landmass. It is predominantly made of old igneous and crystalline rock structures. Basaltic flow, right? Basaltic flow. These are keywords. Himalayan mountains formed due to the convergence of your Indian plate with your Eurasian plate. Beyond convergence, this is largely made of marine sediments and sedimentary rocks. This is the most basic difference. Once you have established this, then you can go on to say which is having the highest risk. You take both your Western Himalayas and Eastern Himalayas zone, the risk of landslides is from very high to high risk zone. And if you take a Western Ghats region, for example, Western Ghats is moderately risky when it comes to landslides. Now, once you establish the fundamental physical geographical structure, then start piling up on physical factors. For example, okay, it's not that I'm going to differentiate each and every one of them. I would narrate them, but let me just give you the ideas in which you can work in both physical and human geographical terms. Fine. Start with reference to rainfall as a causative factor. Rainfall as a causative factor is more tilted towards Western Ghats than your Himalayan mountains. because your average rainfall is much higher, average rainfall of 200 centimeters. In Himalayas, it holds true mostly for eastern Himalayas, but if you come to western Himalayas, it is much, much less. Talk about tectonic stability. We have already established that Western Ghats is a very, very old landmass. At the same time, it is not in any convergent plate margin. You take your Himalayan mountains, on the other hand, it is a convergent plate margin. And since it is a convergent plate margin, there are more opportunities for tectonic instability. Basic factors. Then, once you have addressed the basics of rainfall, stability, then talk about the structure. Western Ghats is an escarpment. It's an escarpment. Escarpment is again a keyword, which is steeply sloping on the western side, then gently sloping on the eastern side. You take your Himalayan mountains. Himalayan mountains is a very, very complexly folded mountain system. Now, because of the structure of this complex folding, there is more potential for causing your landslides. That is why comparatively, on one side of Western Ghats, there is more opportunities for landslides, but Himalayas, it is pretty much uniform across different sections. Meaning makes sense. So once you address the physiogeographical factors, you can actually even more, you can add more. You can talk about elevation. Okay, comparing elevation of Western Ghats with comparing Himalayas. You can say Himalayas is much, much taller mountains. And since these mountains are higher, there is more potential when landslides is an actual impact. Meaning makes sense. Now let's look at our key again. Any UPSC question, especially a geography question, think in terms of both physical and human geography factors. Now, when it comes to human geography factors, let me narrate the basic finds. Let's talk about dam construction. Now, dam construction is a contemporary topic, and we have had disasters in the last 7 to 8 years in the Himalayan region. And one way or the other, they are pretty much attributed to hydroelectric power plants, right? So when it comes to dam construction, it's more of a potential causative factor in Himalayan mountains. Example, you can quote Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. Okay, because Himachal Pradesh, the single state alone, has close to 20 to 25% of India's entire hydroelectric potential. So you can quote this. You look at dam construction, not a leading causative factor in Western Ghats. But let's take an industry like mining. Mining is much more a dangerous factor between your Western Ghats and Himalayan mountains, because within Western Ghats, you can quote states like Kerala, Goa, Karnataka, and even mention specific minerals which are mined in these states. Now, beyond these two, let's look at your infrastructure construction. Infrastructure construction is predominantly being done in the Himalayan mountains for several reasons. The first is development of corridors. For example, take this Chardham Highway project, which is being sanctioned by the government of India. It went to National Green Tribunal, and finally, the Supreme Court of India said that the government can go ahead primarily because of defense and strategic considerations. You can see that Himalayan mountains border a lot of hostile neighbors, and because of this, there are more chances that you should go for infrastructure construction, which might be a potential causative factor for landslides. So this is more tilted towards Himalayas and not towards your Western Ghats in total. Now, along with this, one primary factor, you can simply say, like, during a conclusion, due to climate change, okay, or anthropogenic global emissions. If you take Western Ghats, there is more intensity of cloud bursting events, which is leading to more landslides. And if you take Himalayan mountains, for example, glacial melting in very, very high peaks can affect your soil structure and lead to more landslides, where you can combine that climate change is a common factor, but cloud bursting for Western Ghats and glacial melting and associated landslides and avalanches in Himalayan mountains. So if you think about this, if you're restricting your thought process, you know, always think wider, you can never be narrow. Restricting your thought factor to only physiogeographic factors, when you start writing your differences, it may not be very, very high. You include human geography factors, that's when you hit the jackpot. So I've just given the factors. So when you present it as an answer, this would be a better structure. Let's say you have done the introduction along with a very small map indicating areas which has landslides, you've differentiated, and then you have a small graph as in, you know, places of reasons for Western Ghats, Himalayas, and then the factor of comparison, a causative factor. Which is a causative factor? It'll run down to, you can mention physical 5 and then human 3 or 4. And with the conclusion. 2 pages is more than enough for this answer. Okay, very simple. You're not talking about things which are directly from textbook. Generally, if you start thinking about each and every physiogeographic or human factor, you should be able to fill the answer with relevant points, without any hindrance. Straightforward question, right? Let's go to the next one. Question number five. Right. Despite India being one of the countries of the Gondwana land. So you got a keyword first. It says India is part of Gondwana land. Comma. Its mining industry contributes much less to gross domestic product in percentage. They directly say, see, mining industry contributes to GDP percentage is less. It says discuss. The keyword is discuss. And they are starting with despite. It's like this, you know. Okay. Even though, despite Ravana being a great king, okay, he abducted Sita. Just an example. Like, in spite of the fact that we have all good potential, our mining industry is not operating properly, right? So, in your introduction, it is expected that you address this question of what exactly is Gondwana land. So, Gondwana is one of the oldest land masses, which was part of your large Pangaea. And India is part of this very old landscape, which leaves India with a lot of large amount of mineral resources. Once you have acknowledged the presence of Gondwana land in the introduction, you are expected to show in a map that these are the areas where mineral resources are concentrated. So when you draw the diagram, again, it's not a potential error, but thing is, it's not that you shouldn't be showing the areas which have minerals in India. But the point is, since the question clearly says Gondwana land, if you stick to minerals associated with your Gondwana land, it is much, much easier. So you can highlight major regions. For example, parts of Rajasthan, Chota Nagpur Plateau, Western Ghats, parts of your Peninsula Plateau, and then your Garo, Khasi and Jaintia Hills. This forms part of your Peninsula Plateau. You need not mention your offshore minerals or the minerals which are present in, you know, Assam and then your Himalayan mountains. Question says Gondwana land, so stick to this. This should be fine. So it is expected that you highlight, you know, these are the areas in which there is mining industry present in India. If the segment is done, then you'll have to address this part. So you're expected that you write possibly, so 1 to 2 statements on Gondwana land, then a small map on the right side to indicate where minerals are present in Gondwana land, then to address the question that mining's contribution is less. It's roughly 2.5% contribution to GDP, right? Once this is done, question says discuss. Again, question does not say justify. So again, I'm starting with the basic error you can do. The basic error is you can simply flow the question. Flow the question as in India's mining industry is not doing well even though so many resources are there. Right? Please understand, when someone asks you to discuss, you can also provide counterpoints. See, India's mining industry is improving. That's one more way of writing. Fine? So if you start writing the answer, you will naturally feel that to support the statement, there are multiple reasons. So first thing is, despite, you're going to provide data on the fact that there are so much resources. So when you start writing, mention your Chota Nagpur Plateau region, Western Ghats, and indicate the presence of fossil fuels, metallic, non-metallic minerals in different parts of India. Okay, you can say that the corridor which is combining Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Odisha, and then their Western Ghat region, especially Karnataka, Goa, Kerala, parts of Maharashtra, central region of Maharashtra, southern portion of Andhra Pradesh. Along with the map, you can explain certain minerals also. Once this segment is done, then you're going to say, like, why exactly is the mining industry not contributing properly? Again, I told you, key. Physical factors, human factors. So start one by one. Okay. So whenever you talk about an industry, you know the way to approach the answer. There are factors of industrial production, right? Raw material, market, labor, power, transport. So all you're going to say is, you know what, mining industry is facing challenges. So when you say it is facing challenges, and that is why the GDP contribution is very less, address a question on all these factors. You will be in a position to generate very good amount of points. Talk about location of raw materials. Okay, raw materials are basically present in areas with dense amount of forest area. Hence, getting environmental clearances is an issue. At the same time, if you go for deforestation, it becomes difficult for India for honoring the obligations for United Nations. Nation Framework Convention on Climate Change. Meaning makes sense. Talk that the location areas are actually in areas with large amount of tribal population. Tribal population. So there are restrictions for operation of your mining industry because PESA or tribal rights have to be held on properly. Then you talk about, with reference to location, let's take your resource problem. Even though resources are available, one of the major reasons is the quality of the resources is very poor. For example, if you take coal, the ash content is very high. Example, ash content of coal in India is much higher. Or you can use this word, coking coal is less and non-coking coal is more. That is why India tends to import coal from different parts of Australia. So you talk about the location of raw material and the quality of raw material, right? Talks say that the quality of labor for further processing of industry, okay, especially skilled labor, is not available very close to those regions. Meaning makes sense. You can talk about literacy rate. Once that is done, mention about rugged terrain, which makes it challenging for transporting your mineral resources to market locations. Meaning makes sense. Also mention that the areas in which minerals are present also experience high rainfall, which makes them increasingly disaster prone, which is always a problem with mining industry. India has an average rainfall of more than 100-150 centimeters in the adjoining regions. Give example, let's take Meghalaya. Coal is present, but rainfall is very, very high, and you know the reasons. Orographic rainfall, funneling effects. So because of extremely high rainfall, this is disaster prone. Meghalaya is an excellent example. So if we think about this, we are addressing the factors based on all these things, power, transport, and the location far away from market. If these things are done, then you can address the other dimension too. Like, look at the alternate way. I can say that mining industry has these problems, or I can alternatively say, see, there are other industries which are very natural in India. For example, India has very good fertile agricultural land. Hence, agriculture has the highest concentration of labor, close to 50% of India's population. Simple way of saying that, as in this industry is performing well, so mining industry, not any people are concentrating. Then you can say, as I told you, both physical and the human geography factors is addressed. You know, we talked about tribal population, we talked about literacy rate, we talked about location away from the market. At the same time, we talked about rugged terrain and rainfall. After discussing both these things, question says discuss. You can say India's coal production or India's mineral production has been ramped up in different parts of India, especially in the last 20 or 30 years. You take India's mineral production, we are trying to reach self-sufficiency. Self-sufficiency. More and more minerals are getting discovered in India. For example, last year, the state of Arunachal Pradesh, there was discovery of the metal vanadium, which is quite important, okay, in your industrial development. So you can say that mineral production is being ramped up in India, and you can quote a place in Himalayan mountains, at the same time a place in Chota Nagpur Plateau. So once this is done, then you can mention in conclusion that India is having specific policies for improvement in mining industry. Meaning makes sense. So if you look at this particular discussion also, we have tried to address the basic level points, as in you can think with just a pen and paper. That's it. Meaning makes sense. So very simple question. Physical geography, human geography, that is one point you will miss. Second thing is, need not always fall in line. That's why I give the last 3 points just as a counter argument. Meaning makes sense. So that's a simple question again you would see. Question number 6. 4 and 5 are done. 6. 6 says, what are the environmental implications? Question is very specific. Okay, if they have simply said implications, you can write a lot. Question says, what are the environmental implications of reclamation of water bodies? Reclamation of water bodies into urban land use. Urban land use. See, it seems to be a very specific question. It says, explain with examples. But if you think rationally, it is not difficult at all. All you need to mention is a few wetland regions surrounding the metropolitan cities. That will be more than enough to address this question. Let's try to break it down. Very simple question. Talking about if you start using water bodies as part of urban land use, okay, change the nature of urban water bodies, what are the essential environmental implications which you will achieve from that? See, thing is, you can mention political factors, social factors, but please remember, it's predominantly about environmental consequences. So if you start replacing a water body, start with the most basic things. Okay, first for the water body itself, and then we will move to impact on urban environment. So here again, you can think about what is the direct impact on water body. It's already written, so I'll just take this off. What is the direct impact on the water body? And what is the direct impact on urban land use as in? So when you start doing this, first there is loss of biodiversity, because water bodies support a good amount of wildlife. Very straightforward question. Second one, you lose opportunities for purification of water, because they remain as kidneys of the ecosystem, wetlands, for example. Number three, there are less possibilities of recharge of groundwater, because surface water bodies are the ones through which primarily are able to support your large groundwater requirements. And urban environments consume a large amount of groundwater. So if you start occupying your water bodies and then convert them as part of urban land use, then you will naturally lose recharge of groundwater, recharge potential for groundwater. Moving further, talk about the most basic things, keeping this separately. Like if you start disturbing your water body, it can make your water quality polluted, right? Quality becomes polluted. Is it enough? Mention the environmental complications of this. Environmental complications as in, due to pollution, there are possibilities of biomagnification and bioaccumulation. So this is a specific environmental point. So this is for the organisms which are living in the water bodies and the water bodies themselves. If this part is done, then talk about what happens to the landscape if you convert them. So first thing is, the landscape will increasingly become flood prone, right? Increasingly become flood prone. This acts as a potential for development of new pests and diseases. Okay. It disturbs ecological balance of the rural urban fringe, as in the boundary which connects your urban environment to the rural environment. Ecological balance is disturbed. As I told you, you could add more points in politics, society and economic. But the question clearly says environmental consequences, and that's why we are focused only on environment. Now for the catch in the question. See, if you have written 8 or 9 points, then they mention examples. Mention water bodies of specific metropolitan cities. For example, talk about Musi River in Hyderabad. Talk about Pallikaranai marshland, which is at the outskirts of Chennai. Talk about the wetlands of Kolkata. Okay, the Kolkata wetlands, for example, they have this Ramsar site specification, right? So you can talk about Deepur Bil in Assam, which is actually becoming a waste dump, right? So there are problems of biomagnification and bioaccumulation. So you quote 4 examples of urban environment. For 8 points, your answer stands very much supported. So along with this, you can say that the recent smart city programs launched by Government of India should focus more on sustainable development so that we not exploit the water bodies, but try to increase the floor space index of the present urban environment itself, or go for green bills for conservation of water bodies. Meaning makes sense. Now you can ask me, well, in one of the previous questions, you told us that you can actually go for positives also, because it simply says environmental implications, right? It didn't say negative environmental implications. But point is, on the spot, talking about positive implications of converting a water body, if it is economic and political, it is fine. But environmentally, justifying a point is very difficult. That's why we are stuck to negative in this answer. Okay, I think you're getting the idea. Next one. Question number 7. Again a 10 marker. Question 7. Yeah. Mention the global occurrence of volcanic eruptions in 2021. Global occurrence. Volcanic eruptions. 2021. And their impacts on regional environment. You know, looking at this question, you're tempted to know, okay, fine, I didn't exactly revise the current affairs notes. Even if I revised, for example, I never knew where volcanic eruptions happened in 2021. So what I will do is I'll skip this question. Please don't do that. See, you know that there are areas which are always prone to volcanic eruptions. You look at the paper, you do not know where eruptions occurred in 2021. You can't use any search engine there. So you just go with the flow of the answer and then look for potential areas. You definitely know volcanoes would have erupted in Hawaii. You definitely know volcanoes would have erupted in New Zealand or Indonesia or Japan. It may not be a massive explosion, but these are potential convergent and divergent margins, including Iceland, right? So when you start with introduction, you can say that the distribution of volcanoes across the earth is concentrated in specific parts of the world. For example, 60 to 65% is in the Ring of Fire, 20% in Southeast Asia, and then 10% in Caribbean islands. Just a rough estimate. Once you have done this, provide a world map. Just a rough diagram. Just like we use for India, right? Just a rough diagram. Once the segment is done, then mention areas across the world where there are potential possibilities where you could expect volcanic eruptions. Meaning makes sense that this is for people who do not know what happened in 2021. You're trying to balance the answer. Just mark major regions. You can say Iceland, for example. Okay, mention your New Zealand's, parts of Southeast Asia, Japan, Italy, then Hawaiian Islands, somewhere in the Caribbean. Meaning makes sense. You can say, see, these are the potential areas. Okay, you need to write that. Okay, since the question says global occurrence of volcanic eruptions in 2021, these are potential areas, so you just need to add on to it. You know, areas of convergent or divergent plate margins, convergent or divergent plate margins have more potential for volcanic eruptions due to operation of convective currents which go on in the asthenosphere. And these are important locations, so and so. So you can name 4 to 5 of them. So when you name them, you can separate, you know, examples for some convergent margins, examples for some divergent margins. So we are treating 2021 as any year and indicating major regions. So this is easily your first part of your answer. Never get panicked if the question is specific as in, okay, you are expected to manage on spot, much easier to manage. Once this is done, second part of the question. So part two is straightforward, right? It simply says their impacts on regional environment. Impacts. So this is the fourth question you're following in geography, right? Questions 4, 5, 6 were done. And if you are following, you would know. Impacts always doesn't necessarily mean it is a negative impact. It can also mean positive impact. That is the only thing you need to keep it in mind. So generally, if there is going to be a volcanic eruption, okay, what are the problems you will experience in your regional environment? First is, there is an expected drop in temperature. Expected drop in temperature. Or due to the explosion of large number of aerosols. Large number of aerosols. Or your dust clouds. Number two, changes local. It says regional environment around the region. Changes regional humidity or relative humidity. And your cloud formation. Right? It changes the nature of your soil. If it's going to be an explosion in Hawaii, there are chances that your volcanic eruptions will enter directly into part of water. So in your regional environment, there are possibilities of formation of new rocks. Right? At the same time, your ocean characteristics or the regional sea characteristics will experience some changes. Okay, meaning makes sense because you are introducing large number of aerosols, right? So once you've addressed your climatic factors, your geomorphologic factors, and of course, your changes in your sea environment, especially if it is a volcano which is there in Hawaii, these are points regarding your hydrology too. So geomorphology, climatology, oceanography, directly take points from syllabus on spot. Okay, need not try to be too specific. Once you've addressed the negative challenges as in, then you talk about positive challenges as in. Positive implications as in. For example, ash, volcanic ash is very, very fertile. Okay, so it provides opportunities for better cultivation of agriculture in the near future, even though there is destruction of infrastructure temporarily. Talk about secondary succession because fires, if they are caused as a result of volcanic eruptions, that is lava flow, they will destroy biodiversity, but it provides opportunities for secondary succession. Okay, secondary succession. So since it is going to be secondary succession, naturally your biodiversity will change, and that is good for the environment. Meaning makes sense. So some question which seems to be very specific and not answerable, if you keep calm, if you keep your mind calm and just try to address the question in general format, in the 7 to 7.5 minutes to you have allotted for the question, you can easily score a 4 marker, okay, with 2 diagrams. Okay, always remember both negative and positive implications. The reason we are not too much into human geography is because it says regional environment as in. So you need to associate yourself more with physical geography factors. Meaning makes sense. So every question we are addressing based on the specific word given in the question. So that addresses the fourth one. So 4 questions are done in geography. And question 8, you know, when I took the start of the discussion, I did tell you that some questions are not strictly geographical. You know, some can be a combination of geography, society, at times even history. Always remember this. It's a GS1 question. You address it from all dimensions. Even in your Western Ghats and Himalayan mountain systems, landslides question, you can talk about development of hill stations during a British time period. You can mention British time period. Never at any point of time a question is a strictly geography question. You can add points from history and society. Always keep that in mind, right? So this question, for example, it says, why is India? Why? India, subcontinent. Says elaborate. There is a catch. It did not say discuss. It did not say analyze. It does not say evaluate, assess, nothing. It simply says elaborate, which means what is expected in this question. You are supposed to take the standard India is a subcontinent. If you look carefully, it doesn't talk about Indian subcontinent region. It mentions a political boundary, right? India is a political boundary. So political boundary is called as subcontinent. See, if you understand conceptually what a continent is, addressing this is nothing. So let me address that part. See, actually, the basic definition of a continent is, before I start with the introduction, hold on. Basic definition of a continent is a very large land area which is mostly isolated from the rest of the world. You take any major continent. You take South America, North America, Australia, Antarctica, and then your Africa. All of them are mostly surrounded by water. Even if there is a land connection to any of the other continents, it's a very, very small strip of land. For example, North and South America is connected only through your Panama, your Isthmus of Panama. And you take Africa as the Sinai Peninsula connecting with Egypt. So it's a very small land boundary. Naturally, you will ask me, well, Europe and Asia not separated. Well, I will address it at the end of the discussion. Okay, consider it a bonus point, which is more of a trivia. I'll address that. But point is, a continent is a very large land area, which is isolated from rest of the world. So if land is isolated from rest of the world, it is expected it will have its own unique, physiogeographic factors. And if human beings are settled there, it will lead to specific human geography factors which will isolate this region from rest of the world. Okay, this is the understanding of what a continent is. Now, in your introduction, you are expected to say why India is a subcontinent. So when you start with the introduction, start from this. No, I'm not asking you to define continent is, but at least in the introduction, you're expected to say that India is actually isolated, right? India is isolated from most parts of the world because of several barriers. Okay, there is a 7,500 kilometer coastline which isolates it from interaction. At the same time, you have Himalayan mountains which run from the northwestern region to the eastern region, and it forms a physiographic barrier which kind of separates it from the other countries in general. So if you can mention that, naturally we are addressing the question on what is continent. I know that most of you may not exactly know what a continent is. There are chances that the most basic things in geography are not learnt when you prepare for a UPSC exam. But the idea is, in your introduction, you are expected to acknowledge that India is semi, at least, even though you can infiltrate through the desert and Khyber and Bolan Pass, at least address that India is isolated or semi-isolated. That's the first point you need to understand. If this segment is done, then writing these two factors is not a problem at all. You need to say that it has a unique set of physiographic and human geographical features. Let me just write a list. Think in terms of diversity diversity and uniqueness of India with the rest of the world in terms of these factors. Okay, I'll go one by one. Mountain systems, rainfall, forest area, agriculture, biomes. Biomes as in you have a glacier biome, evergreen forest biome, desert biome, right? You have a deciduous biome as in a semi-evergreen forest or a deciduous forest. You get the idea? Biome. That is in terms of forest area, in terms of biomes and ecosystem, specifying plants and animals which are endemic to India from different parts of the world. Diversity and uniqueness. Fine, this is just your physiogeography. Let me elaborate. Think about language. Think about religion. No country in the world can boast about the, you know, the fact that six different religions are in India. Talk about cultural variation. Talk about the number of tribes. Okay, you address this point based on all these factors of potential variations in India, both your geography and society, then there is no question that why India is a subcontinent with its own specific diversity and uniqueness which separates it from the rest of the world. So we start from separation, that is the physiological boundaries which prevent India, okay, from which kind of semi-isolates India. Then you address each factor one by one. I don't think I should talk about examples when it comes to languages or examples when it comes to culture. You can write yourself, but this is the general set in which you need to address this answer. Okay, never restrict your thought processes, geography alone. Take points from society, the answer is done. Very simple. So this bonus point I'll tell you at the end of the discussion. Well, if you have patience, that is, right? So 5-10 markers are done. Now stepping into the 15 markers, right? Just a second. So question 8 is done. And where are we? 13 is democratic state system. Yeah, 14. Right, question number 14 says, briefly mention major mountain systems. Major mountain systems of the world, alignment of major mountain ranges of the world, and explain impact on local weather conditions with examples. I'll tell you what mistakes you might tend to do. Hold on a second. We'll just start with the mistake straight ahead. Two parts in the question, right? Answer 15 marker. Yeah. 250 words. First thing is, remember, whenever there are two parts in the question, you isolate the segments and give equal weightage. When you see the first part, and if you think you know this well, there is a natural tension, especially for geography option students, and you tend to override the first part. Never do that. Equal split. If you get 3 pages, 1.5 and then 1.5, barring the quarter page or 3 to 4 lines of introduction. So now, when you start the answer, link both the parts. Okay, you can say that mountain systems, there are several mountain systems across the world which span across thousands of kilometers, and they directly impact both climatic and weather conditions, right? Once this segment is done, it simply says, briefly elaborate mountain systems, so detailed discussion is not needed. Again, your world map segment. See, map drawing is very essential when you write your geography question, because a map is worth 150 to 200 words. So if you can just mention, okay, Equator, Cancer, Capricorn. You just mentioned the major mountain systems, Andes, Rockies, you know, Alps Mountains, Atlas Mountains, Himalayan Mountains, maybe Drakensberg here, maybe Great Dividing Ranges. Fine, maybe a Scandinavian Mountains, that is more than enough. Just major mountain systems spread across the world. Fine. If you're done, it's something which is on top of your head, then it simply says, briefly describe the alignment of mountains. You can simply say, just like we started with volcanic systems. Now here, we never went for detailed description because the question doesn't demand it. For example, this one. Simply said, global occurrence of volcanic eruptions. You just mentioned convergent and divergent plate margins. Here there is hydrostatic pressure. And due to hydrostatic pressure, these are more prone to volcanic eruptions, right? Something like that here, when it comes to your major mountain systems, just mention that most of these fold mountain systems, like in the diagram itself, you can mark Himalayas or Rockies or Andes. That's much easier for the examiner, the person who's correcting. Once you have done this, below this, just the basic discussion, baseline discussion of 3 to 4 points, because when you start describing the map itself, it should, like along with the map and the basic idea, it should cover at least one page and 1 1/4. So you can start writing as in, the major mountain systems across the world are predominantly present on plate margins, especially the convergent ones, which are subaerial mountains, for examples. Okay, we're not talking about submarine mountains, because question says weather. So there is no point in talking about your Mid-Atlantic Ridge Fault Block Mountain. No, that's not needed. So you can simply say subaerial mountains, predominantly convergent plate margins. For example, you can just mention Himalayan mountains, the convergence of plates of India and Eurasia, Rockies mountains, it's North America and Pacific, Andes mountains, it is your South America with your Nazca plate. Just a small description. You do not go too much beyond this, because it simply says briefly, just a basic idea of where your mountain systems are aligned. So possibly you finish 1 page or 1 1/4. You've done this. Key point is weather conditions. I'll tell you one big mistake which a candidate can do. You look at a mountain system, you are naturally tempted to write this. Right? You're talking about the long-term impact of the mountain. Like, okay, mountain ecosystems are present. This is the impact on your climatic conditions of the place. But please note, that is not asked. They're very specific about weather conditions. And you know how weather is different from climate. Weather is highly temporal, right? So it's the condition of atmosphere at a given space and time. So if your answer is writing about monsoon systems, formation of deserts, etc., weakening of Hadley cell, all those factors, you're not hitting the question. You're expected to talk about weather systems. And if you think about local weather conditions, which are highly temporal, you can easily write content from your local winds. For example, okay, since the question says examples, start from the most basic ones, right? So the wind on the leeward side of a mountain is called as a phoon wind. Phoon wind, you know this. This is a warm, dry wind. Warm, dry wind. And you can say that these phoon winds are extensively present in different mountain systems of the world. For example, okay, I'm just going to draw the map segment, right? You can mention Rocky Mountains. You can say Rocky Mountains govern the weather conditions of two different regions in North America. For example, Chinook, right? So Chinook in North America goes on the leeward side of mountains, and this wind enables cultivation of your crops during late winter because it melts snow. At the same time, you can mention Santa Ana in the southwestern portion of North America, which causes your forest fires in California. You see the question? Question is mountain systems dictating local weather conditions. Your two wind systems in North America itself is very, very specific. You can use the same example for your South America. In South America, okay, based on your Andes mountains, you have this wind system called Zonda, right? So Zonda again is a problem. Not just Zonda, you can take your Canterbury mountains in New Zealand and you can talk about a phoon wind which is present in New Zealand. Take Italy for example. Okay, you have your Alps mountains. Based on the presence of Alps mountains, you have your phoon winds moving north, and in your southern Germany, there is increase in temperature. Again, mountain system, local weather condition. Let's take Himalayan mountains, right? Just draw a rough map of India and mention Himalayan mountains. Due to presence of Himalayan mountains, the weather condition during winter season is not severely disturbed because it acts as a barrier for winter cold winds which come from central Siberia or northern part of China. Okay, so this itself addresses your weather condition question. Now, it's not that you need to talk about seasonal wind example. You talk about a diurnal wind example. For example, mountain system is generally present at the south of a mountain range, a very elaborate mountain range, every evening due to the presence of mountain breeze. There is formation of fog, which is very close to the valley, which causes temperature inversion conditions. Look at the question again. Mountain systems, and weather. Okay, we're talking about something highly temporal. So this is the answer rather than talking about climate. It's not that you shouldn't be talking about climate. You can talk about climatic system. That should not be the major part of your answer. For example, Himalayan mountains, right? Himalayan mountains influence climates. This weakens hardly cell. Weakens hardly cell. Helps in the movement of southwest monsoon system. The entire monsoon system is based on this. Due to the presence of Andes mountains, you get Patagonia desert. Patagonia desert. The dividing ranges, which is present in Australia, dictates regional distribution of rainfall. Dividing ranges of Australia, regional distribution of rainfall in eastern part of Australia. So you can add these points, but these points should not dominate your answer. Question is mountain systems, weather conditions, not mountain systems and climate. So you mention weather systems. We have already got 3 to 4 diagrams, just these ones. You draw on this, then as a concluding factor, not just whether if climate is taken into consideration, your 15 marker with 4 diagrams is perfectly okay. So if you think about this, we have more than 5 diagrams to support your answer and relevant content to the question. So if you thought the volcanic eruptions question was slightly off because it was specific, no. I would tell you this is one question where more aspirants might miss the targets because they may take weather as climate. So we just have 3 more 15 markers. Question number 14 is done. Next one. 15 is very interesting, right? Very specific. It says melting of. How does the melting of Arctic ice glaciers and Antarctic ice glaciers? Arctic glaciers and the Antarctic are different. How do they affect the weather patterns? How do they affect the weather patterns? And then human activities. Human activities. Explain. A question cannot be very specific, you know, it's extremely specific. And in the question itself, they are helping you. This 15 marker says physical geography factor and human geography factor. You address both the part of the question, then you're not going to deviate here. The key in the question is this part, differentiate, right? So in your introduction, it is expected that you acknowledge that glaciers are melting in Arctic and Antarctic region. Now here a map may not be helpful, simply drawing the earth, mentioning Arctic and Antarctic circle, right? That's simply the areas which is known from the question itself. So in the introduction, please specify there is increase in global average temperatures. Because of this, there is noticeable retreat of Arctic glaciers. At the same time, Antarctic glaciers are getting to break down. Now before you start differentiating the impacts, it is essential that post the introduction itself, you mention how your Arctic region is different from your Antarctic region in terms of their physiography. If you do that, okay, then your answer is immediately done. Or you can structure the answer differently. Simply say Arctic region, this is the basic features of the Arctic region. And after the basic features, these are the implications for weather and human activities. Then after finishing your first part of the answer, come to Antarctic region. These are the features and then these are the implications. This is also one way of writing. There is no wrong way of writing. So since the question says differentiate, either go for a tabulation. Features, then the implications. Or you say, no sir, I'm not comfortable for tabulation. There is time pressure. Hence, I'd like to finish everything and then rethink everything for Antarctic. No issues. As long as you differentiate, there is no problem at all. Tabulation is easier for a person to correct when he's writing. Now let's address the points which you can write. Okay. So if you take the basic difference between Arctic and Antarctic, it's about domination of land and oceans. Arctic is predominantly ocean dominated or water dominated. Fine. At the same time, the glaciers which you see right here are directly floating on ice. You take your Antarctic region, for example, it is mostly dominated by land. And when we say land, you're talking about large number of ice shelves present over land where the thickness is more than 2 to 3 kilometers. So this basic difference, it is expected that you acknowledge. Once the physical factors are acknowledged, then you come to population density. The Arctic region is relatively, you don't use the word, it doesn't make sense, right? So relatively highly populated. See, I know that polar climate has very low density of population, but comparing Arctic and your Antarctic region, we can definitely say it's highly populated. Meaning makes sense. If this is established, then go for the question. How does it affect my weather pattern and human activities? Start from Arctic. right? Weather, human activities. So weather is actually an output of climatology factors, right? So you can simply say, due to glacial melting, there is retreat of glaciers, which contributes to more undulations in the polar vortex. This could lead to more possibility of cold air invasion from the Arctic region. For example, northeastern part of Canada or your northeastern parts of Siberia, right? Northwestern parts of Europe. You can quote examples like these. Meaning makes sense. Now, apart from this, you need to go for a peripheral factor, then introduce weather. Like, for example, due to change in your glaciers, ocean currents will be affected. You can either quote your East Greenland currents, or your Oyashio currents, or your Labrador current. Any ocean current is okay. You can mention, due to increase in presence of fresh water in the Arctic region, the ocean current nature will change, which will change the localized weather patterns of these regions. Meaning makes sense. Once you finish your weather activities, then change in fishing grounds. Due to change in nature of ocean currents, the navigation phenomenon is affected. Activities like polar vortex or meandering of jet streams makes things increasingly disaster prone, which means there is more necessity that human activities become more adapted to climate change. Meaning makes sense. This is specific to the Arctic region. Once this segment is done, then you have to address the Antarctic. If you think very carefully, I didn't talk about polar bears. Why didn't we talk about polar bears? Because it was not directly there in the question. If you want, you can add, but I don't think it's going to add too much in terms of value to your answer. When it comes to Antarctic region, mention that new areas or new ice shelves might get disturbed, adding more and more fresh water, which contributes to significant increase in sea level and associated weather changes. Okay, you don't find a significant change in the Arctic. Coming to the second one, okay, mentioned sudden stratospheric warming, which was a menace in the Antarctic region 2 years back, okay, 2018-19. So once you mention SSW here, and then you mention your polar vortex variation and then cold air invasion, naturally your Arctic and Antarctic is disturbed. Then in terms of human activities, you can say that population density is lesser in the Antarctic, again, compared to the Arctic region. Hence, mostly the research stations and their locations are affected. Research stations and climate research will be affected. And a localized region of fishing grounds which are present close to the Antarctic region, where the west wind drift is present, right? WWD. Or Antarctic circumpolar current, so that gets affected. Fine. So once you describe the basic variation between Arctic and Antarctic, naturally answers begin to flow. Okay, without any issues, you can quote your examples also based on the regions, because you know where population density is high between Arctic and Antarctic. Okay, so coming to question number 8. Fine. Right, this is not again strictly a geography question. I'm pretty sure you would write more points if it was asked in gender studies paper 2. But geography also provides the opportunities. Look at this. Discuss multidimensional implications of uneven distribution of mineral oil in the world. 15 marker, 250 words. Let's hit this. See, I'll tell you the introduction, right? So you can mention that based on the global map or global distribution, we can understand that mineral oil resources are concentrated only in specific parts of the world, or you can go for an alternate introduction. Okay, you can simply say, for example, there is a cartel called OPEC, and OPEC controls close to 40 to 45 distribution of oil. And this indicates concentration of mineral oil wealth only in certain countries. So if you mention OPEC, there is possibility of numbers, or you can mention as in 10 to 15 countries control close to 50% of all mineral oil resources. Meaning makes sense. So in the introduction, try to go for numbers. Then introduction, you are expected to indicate the map. So if you think properly, you're trying to use maps for every question possible in every possible way. Okay, because this will save a lot of time. I know that I'm repeating the statement again, but please remember, okay, if there is something which needs to be reinforced again and again, there is nothing wrong in repetition. Now for the major regions across the world, just highlight. For example, countries in northern portion of South America, okay, parts of Alaska, parts of North Africa, parts of Central and West Africa, parts of West Asia, some parts of Indonesia. Fine. Then you have parts again, parts of Norway, okay, offshore oil that is, and then maybe some parts of Russia or Eastern Europe you can mark. Then you can say that, so in this very large land area, only some countries are controlling wealth. Now, see, some questions you get carried away because this question can be addressed several ways. We'll just think about several ways you can address, then the basic level points. It says discuss, which means no one is asking you to discuss only, asking you to narrate only the positive implications. It can be positive or negative. So either write your answer as simply, okay, let me put it in the next one. Either write your answer simply as positive and negative. Positive implications, negative implications of uneven distribution of oil wealth. Or go parameter-wise, economic implications, ecological implications and environmental implications, political implications, social implications, geopolitical implications, again, under political point. This is more than enough. Or you can go for one more way. Areas which are rich in oil, what are the implications for them? Areas which are poor in oil, what are the implications for them? So any method is fine. All methods will fetch you marks. Take, choose, or any method in which you are comfortable in writing and which you think you can present large amount of points without thinking too much as in. Okay, if you ask me, I would prefer this actually, because once you start talking about economic, environmental, political, and social, you generate points on top of the head and you can start narrating them. Fine. We'll see the basic idea, the basic level points which you can generate for a 15 marker. All you have to do is you start with the importance of mineral oil. So crude oil is not just a fossil fuel reserve for the energy needs, but it is also the primary driver for petrochemicals or petrochemical industry. If this is done, then your points will flow when you start to elaborate on these dimensions. So one by one, okay, economic. Question clearly says, look at this. Uneven distribution of mineral oil. We've established this fact. So when you write economic implications, okay, you can write in both in terms of areas which oil is present and areas in which there is less concentration. When you talk about economic implications, think in terms of positively. So for the oil-rich countries, so some positives. Okay, there is easier contribution to economic development. Okay, increase in economic development. Okay, increasing your gross domestic product because of presence of oil. There is noticeable increase in per capita income. Noticeable increase in per capita income. For example, countries like Qatar, United Arab Emirates, mention Saudi Arabia, Kuwait. Fine. At the same time, you look at it negatively, there are chances this will lead to civil war and political instability leading or threatening your economic implications. So for civil war, you can quote countries from Northern Africa, for example, Algeria. Okay, this might be a strictly political point. I just thought about negative and inserted in. Economically, negative point, you can say that over-dependence on a particular commodity will be detrimental to the economy if oil price crashes. Example, Venezuela. There are issues of inflation, right? Meaning makes sense. So once you have done this, you can say that economic again, political. Global alliances are dictated based on countries which have oil wealth. Number two, okay, geopolitical implications for construction of pipelines. Construction of pipelines for transport of oil. Transport of oil. Because pipeline construction will actually lead to more neighboring countries coming to some sort of collaboration or convergence, even if there are going to be differences politically. I mean, it makes sense. So political implications. Then you talk about your social implications. Countries which have high amount of oil, due to economic development, you have population density increasing. So there is increase in population density in desert environments. Increase in population density in desert environments. There is noticeable increase in lifestyle. Lifestyle of countries which control large amount of oil. Fine. Based on this, you write your environmental implications. Environmental implications first from increase in population. Due to increase in population density, there is more damage done to desert ecosystem. Desert ecosystem, right? So this is present in your West Asia. For extraction of oil, there is more deforestation being done. Deforestation being done. Example, Brazil, parts of your South America. You can mention Congo, parts of your Central Africa. Based on population density, mention that there is more necessity for extraction of water, which naturally affects your desert plants and animals. Desert plants and animals. Mention requirement of fresh water leads to more desalination plants. And desalination plants change the salinity of your regional marine ecosystem, which is again a problem for fishes. You get the idea. So basic points in terms of economic, political, social should easily give you enough 10 to 11 points based on, you know, along with the introduction part, and your map 15 marker is an easy play here. Because it simply says discuss. That is why I have discussed about both positive factors in terms of increase in per capita income and your GDP. And then negative factors is in terms of if this could lead to civil war and maybe inflation issues as countries in Venezuela. Then the political ones, then the social ones, then your environmental ones also. Okay, you can mention oil spills. Okay, and when it comes to oil spills, certain countries are responsible, whereas there is no responsibility for, I mean, there is no limited responsibility for a country which is actually leading to these oil spills. You can mention examples in Gulf of Mexico. You get the idea? So too many points for this one when you try to address it. Last question from my side. Question number 17. Again, this is the second question I am dealing with when it comes to not strictly geography or society. The question is this. 17. What are the main socio-economic implications arising out of development of IT industries in major cities of India. Right? So after this, we need to discuss a general trivia regarding Europe. See, the point is, if you look at your IT industries, when you start with the introduction, please mention again the contribution to GDP. So close to 60% of the GDP is contributed by services sector, and your information communication technology is a major contributor. Fine. Then you mention, you know, these are the major metropolitan cities in India where you have a concentration of your IT industries. So just mention the major metros, for example, starting from Delhi, Noida region, Mumbai, Pune, Nasik region, Bangalore, Chennai corridor, Hyderabad, and then Kolkata. Okay, you can mention the corridor itself or even the major cities is fine, right? Once you have done this, answer can be addressed again. Same rookie mistake. When we say implications, writing only positive implications. Okay, you can write negative implications also. Question clearly says both socio and economic. So structure your answer like this. Either write social implications, positive points, negative points. Or go for economic implications, positive points, negative points. Answer is done. Fine. That's it. So before we end the discussion and then go to Europe, some preliminary ideas for thinking. So when we talk about social implications in terms of positives, right? Okay, you can say that this provides opportunities for different castes, communities to work together. communities to work together, right? It strengthens, you know, social capital in a city, because large number of people migrate to the city. So this contributes to more rural urban migration, which strengthens the importance of cities, right? Migration patterns. When you talk about society and negatives, okay, talk about problems associated with rural urban migration. There is more, chances of isolation for the employees who work in the sector. There are chances of increase in class inequality, because those who work in the services sector are predominantly present in the skills area or literates. Okay, so there are chances of, you know, so, you know, so not social inequality in terms of caste sense, you can mention class inequality, because IT employs people who are already skilled. So this will increase the point. You can mention digital divide also, right? Now talk about your economics. Now here is when you directly address in terms of your geography part. Meaning makes sense. So first the positives. Okay, cities becoming drivers of GDP growth. GDP growth of the country, GDP growth of the state. Talking about more forward and backward linkages. Forwards, backward linkages, leading to the development of auxiliary industries. For example, if IT sector develops, naturally the associated electronics and hardware. Okay, for IT employees, you need transport. Meaning makes sense. For IT employees, you need hotels, food. So all the associated industries, forward and backward linkages. Example you can quote. Post this mention agglomeration, right? Important clusters for growth will be created, clusters in urban agglomerations. For example, the Bangalore IT corridor is the fourth largest IT sector in the world. So due to lack of space, I'm going to the next slide. Once you've finished economic in positive sense, talk in terms of negative sense. Okay, it creates islands of regional development. Okay, when it happens in metropolitan cities, always be specific. So just mention Maharashtra. Maharashtra is a very good case study. And then talk about your Mumbai, Nasik, Pune corridor. Okay, so this is an area with high amount of development and high per capita income. Fine, but whereas here, there is poor development. Okay, just a very small map. As a case study, you can talk about this. Post islands of regional development, in terms of economic inequality, you can say that the income level, okay, is slowly becoming stagnant in the IT sector. Okay, prospects of growth are more and more limited. Due to rural urban migration, there is stress on economic resources and infrastructure of the city. So this is a negative one due to rural urban migration. Meaning makes sense. Fine. As I told you, I think we talked about this when it came to this question of your water bodies, and then when you start converting water bodies into land use for urban landscape. So point is, whenever you write these social and economic implications, at least for 3 or 4 places, if you can provide a particular corridor. I've drawn one diagram alone, talking about Mumbai, Nasik, Pune. You can take Chennai or Kolkata, okay, in terms of Tamil Nadu or West Bengal. Then you just quote 3 or 4 examples, your answer is done. So that was the actual purpose of the discussion. Fine, the purpose of the discussion is not to simply read points from the textbook, but on the spot, when you look at a question, in a short time frame, how exactly to organize your thoughts. So the takeaway should be this. Any question you see, it can be both positive and negative. Any question you see, it is not necessary, if it is going to be discussed, okay, or analyze or evaluate, it is not necessary that you always go with the flow of the statement. You can go for reverse currents also. Any question in geography, talk about both physical and human. And any question, always remember to make sure that if the question specifically says environmental implications, okay, we saw that with reference to, I think, that Arctic-Antarctic question or the environmental implications of reclamation of water bodies. If the question clearly says environment, then writing a social or economic point is not necessary. You can add them, but your valuation will be based on this, because as a bureaucrat, you're expected to answer to the question asked, right? So before we close the discussion, just one point, okay, to answer your question, So based on the definition of continent, five continents are there, right? You find North America, South America, Australia, Antarctica, and Africa. I explained this at the start of the discussion. So technically, there should be six continents only. The sixth continent should be Eurasia. But we have two more continents. We call them Europe and Asia. This was because of a mistake done by Greeks. So based on the location of Greece, if you think about this, Europe is western side of Greece and Asia is eastern side of Greece. So that's how they addressed when they started writing geography, and that was stuck on. And Europe has its own unique cultural characteristics which differentiate it from any other part of the world. And that is why we call Europe as a continent. So more than a physiogeographical region, it is a cultural region. But India, the subcontinent question which under discussion, was not just a cultural region as Europe, but as its own uniqueness in diversity and physiography. So that ends the discussion for geography. Thank you.
Greetings to all. If you see that GS paper 1 in 2021, every year they are making certain changes. If you see this year, the question is overall of nature, and they try to cover all in a particular subject. At the same time, sometimes a cross subject analysis question is being also asked. For example, if you see this year, history and social issues are always being clubbed. So even sometimes it is difficult to delineate between whether it's a social issues question or it is difficult to delineate of the history question. How would you find it? Syllabus is there. If you see the syllabus of the GS1, first, the 2 to 3 stars or 5 stars are related to history. Next is related to the social issues, 3 to 4 stars. And last 3 to 4 stars are geography. And how they are asking, earlier, 2000, when after changing of the pattern, out of 250, how did they ask? Is first exclusively 75 marks, 80 to 90 marks, first full of history question. For example, 1 to 7, history question. Next, 8 to 13 or 14 is related to social issues questions. And remaining is the 15 to 20 is the geography question. So it's very easy for the aspirants to answer according to the specific. Because earlier they asked, but last 3 years, they changed the pattern. How they're asking is, they're asking one or two questions from history. Immediately they jump to the social issues, 2 to 3 questions, and they jump to the geography, 2 to 3 questions, especially the 10 mark question. Again, they're coming back to history, social issues, and the geography. So thus, what they demand, UPSC demand is, not just the subject-wise analysis, you have to interrelate the 2 to 3 different subjects. Even if you see this year, cryptocurrency-related question is asked. Normally, it is a science-centric question that will be asked in that subsequent GS paper. But it is asked, how cryptocurrency had an impact on the society? So that's what the UPSC demand is. GS means not just the GS. So you have to answer in overall aspects. So keep this in this mind. So with this, let us straight away enter approach this year question paper. If you see that, the first question to the history, question number 1 is the history, evaluate the nature of the Bhakti literature and its contribution to the Indian culture. So here, question is very specific. One is the nature and is the contribution to political, social, no, the particular is to the culture. The question is very specific, so you have to answer very specific. And then what shall be your introduction is Bhakti movement. Bhakti movement shall be your introduction. Right, Bhakti movement in that sense started in South India, that too in Tamil country, by means of Alvars, Nayanmars, by 7th and 8th century. Otherwise, if you forget, you can write Pallava period and Cholas. And the 14th, 15th, even it entered into North. In North, there is a two sect. It's the Saguna school, another is the Nirguna school. That's what introduction, that's enough. And the Bhakti movement had overall impact. In that one impact is the Bhakti literature. So Bhakti movement had a multidimensional impact. In that one impact is the Bhakti literature. Our question is this. So one paragraph or 1.5 paragraph, you have to explain everything of this. Now straight away come to the question. the nature of the bhakti literature. So first of all, you should know the bhakti literature, right? What are the bhakti literature things is you have to, literature means language, Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, Hindi, Marathi, Odia language, right? Bengali language, Rajasthani language. In this much of things, Assamese language, even Assamese also, even Punjabi, that is Sikhism. So you have to have the very broader idea. How, it's a very big question. It's a, like an optional 60 mark question. How you are going to satisfy the evaluator is the matter. So what is the nature of the bhakti? You straight away come to the bhakti literature, one or two nature. For example, it is first nature is the related to regional language. So first and foremost is regional language. Almost all the bhakti literature discard Sanskrit and promote the regional language. It's the first nature of this. Right. Second thing is, its verses are so simple that it could reach to the common man. It's a nature of the bhakti literature. And third thing is, the nature is, they opposed to the presence of the Hindu concept of idol worship, image worship, so on. So they acted as, the nature is, it is an answer to the prevailing social condition and the cultural condition and religious condition. Answer to the social and religious condition, always the nature of the bhakti is like this. So how did the nature of the social condition is? Common men, right? And even women's emancipation happened here. Women contributed. Even some of the verses were written by the women. For example, Andal in that Alvars, Mirabai, Vaishnava Bhakti, that is the nature. And another nature of the Bhakti movement is, the movement is try to appeal the common man, try to reach the common man, even particularly how the bhakti literature, the first and foremost is, how the bhakti literature nature is, the saint or the reformer consider himself in love, himself or herself in love with the God. For example, if you see Alvars, Nayanmars, many were the male, but even though male, they first fell in love with the Shiva, or they first fell in love with Vishnu, then only they started to write. In the case of women, Andal completely fell in love. Mirabai completely fell in love with Lord Krishna. Then the verses were there. So this is the nature. So discarded Sanskrit, promotion and wrote in the regional language. What are all the regional languages is this? And second thing is, they try to answer the prevailing social condition and religious condition. And especially they opposed the so-called orthodox belief. Actually, this is also answer to the socio-religious problem of that condition. And nature is, it is a reaction to the prevailing Buddhism and Jainism in the case of South. And it's a reaction to the Islamic Sufism ideas. So they promoted wider base. So just to put 2 to 3 lines in each point, that's over. That is what nature of the bhakti literature. And then you contribute to the culture, that is a second. So first I discuss nature. Next I come to what one is, the contribution. If you see the contribution, the first and foremost contribution is the growth of regional language. For Tamil, Telugu, Kannada. If you see Kannada, you can see Basava, Lingayat sect. So while emphasizing that, try to make one or two movement in that Lingayat sect. And in the case of Telugu, Annamachari, a great saint of Annamachari promoted Telugu language. And if you go to Assam, Sri Shankaradeva of Saivist sect, Vaishnavist sect, sorry, Shankaradeva of the Vaishnavist sect, so promoted that. So first thing, it promoted the regional language. And come to Marathi. Marathi is Abhanga. The Abhanga of the Marathi Vithoba cult, that's a Vithala cult. So first regional. And second is, it is the base. It is the base for the music, culture and dance. Because if you want to dance, if you want to go for music, you need some theme. Almost all the themes were taken from the bhakti literature. The best bhakti literature is the Gita Govind. Jayadeva's Gita Govind. That is the base. From the base only, almost all kind of themes for dance is being taken in northern part. Right? Gita Govind is the best thing. And why not? In the case of the dance and drama, it is Ramacharitamanas. Ramacharitamanas of Tulsidas. If that is the present-day Ramayana and Valmiki Ramayana or Kamparamayana here, right, that is the contribution of that. So second. And the third, if come to the painting, if you come to the painting, again the themes are taken. Themes are taken from here only. What kind of themes are taken here is again the Gita Govind. Right. If you go to Mithila school, the best example is the themes are taken from Ramayana. If you go to the Pahari painting, Rajasthani painting, full of the Ramayana Mahabharata themes are taken. Right. That's a third contribution. So thus, and fourth contribution of the culture is it broadened the so-called Vedic religion to the Brahmanical religion, actually to what religion is the Hindu religion. So it broadened the religion and brought it to the common man. So because of the bhakti, it became the common man language. Common man religion. And bhakti literature is the common man literature. So this is the way you have to take it. So just to give the point, because this question is so broad, it's difficult. It's difficult to satisfy. So try to give. Otherwise, if you wanted to answer everything, you will be land in trouble because it's a first question. Normally, what is the mentality of the student is they wanted to give well, very well in the first question and landing into trouble. So within the time specified, you write and move on to the subsequent question. Next, question number two. Trace the rise, growth of socio-religious reform movement with a special reference to Young Bengal and Brahma Samaj. Again, it's a wide question. So one is trace growth of socio-religious reform movement. So first 5 marks you have to write of this. And next 5 marks you have to write the Young Bengal group, another is the Brahma Samaj group. Then only your answer is complete. Right. If you see the trace and growth, normally the trace and growth of socio-religious is what you are studying in modern Indian history is socio-religious reform movement of 19th century. Please, socio-religious reform movement was started much earlier. Even bhakti movement is also called socio-religious reform movement. So keep it as such. So in modern Indian history, 19th century, the starting of the socio-religious reform movement. What are all the reasons? That's why trace the rise and growth. Right? So what are all the causes of this, the socio-religious reform movement traces? So first you can write both the positive one as well as reactionary idea. What is the positive things? Import of Western education system. So because of Western education system, Western ideas came. Many Indians studied that and started to question the prevailing condition. Why Eastern education system? Why not to study? So first is Western education system. Second thing is the India's glorious past was exposed by means of archaeological survey of India, by means of Asiatic society. James Prinsep deciphered the Ashokan inscription, which give a boost to the Indians. What's a boost to the Indians? Yes, British were telling that Indians were unfit for ruling. But if you see the archaeological evidences, it saw that Indians were fit once upon a time ruled by ourselves. That's like a son of Sahil concept. So it gave a boost to the Indians. It's a second. And the third thing is arrival of Western culture. In the case of arrival of Western culture, some of them accepted the Western culture, some of them rejected the Western culture. So these are all the this side you have to write a positive side. If you see the negative side, racial discrimination. It's a reaction. Racial discrimination. And the second thing is some Christian missionaries, missionary activities and the conversion. These were the main for the rise of the socio-religious reformation movement of that. Right. And the next is the growth. Growth of socio-religious. If you see the growth, you have to write All India perspective. What's the growth? First socio-religious reformment. It's a Bengal Renaissance. So started with the Bengal Renaissance, initially confined to the Bengal, later gradually spread into Bombay and Madras area, then in Punjab. So it's a Bengal Renaissance, then Bombay, then Madras, then Punjab, just to give one or two examples. In the case of Bengal Renaissance, only Young Bengal and Brahma Samaj is there, and Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, you can write. In the case of Bombay province, you can write of Atmaram Pandurang, Antadaba Pandurang, Pradhana Samaj, Paramahamsa Mandali, these kinds of organization in the Bombay. And in the case of South, yes, you can write SNDP movements, Periyar, Virasalingam Bantulu. And in the case of Lahore, Arya Samaj. Though Arya Samaj initially started in Bombay, very famous in Punjab region. So what is the growth? So you first started. It's like growth of your institution. First will start in a small place, and they will spread across India. Likewise, so growth is like this. Right, over. Because you can't write everything. You don't have time. And next you come to special reference to Young Bengal. So you have to write at least half page, even more than a half page for this, as well as for the Brahma Samaj. Brahma Samaj wise, you would not feel any difficulties. If you take Young Bengal, that alone you will feel some, could have felt some difficulties. If you see Young Bengal, Henry Vivian D'Arcio, an Anglo-Indian, right? An Anglo-Indian, Henry Vivian D'Arcio, he was a founder and he worked as a professor, teacher in the Hindu college. So the Hindu college can be considered as the origin of the Young Bengal and the Bengal Renaissance. So Hindu college, that Hindu college was started by David Hare, that is different things. No need to go into that. So Hindu college, Young Bengal by Henry Vivian D'Arcio. Then what they emphasized of the Young Bengal is, first thing is rational thinking. Rational thinking is important. And second is scientific temper. So first is asked the youngsters to go for rational thinking, scientific temper, and highly attracted by the Western ideas and the Western culture. Completely influenced by Western ideas and Western culture. That's why, because of that, they completely rejected the prevailing social condition and religious condition of the Bengal. That is the reason they witnessed the reactionary force from the so-called Orthodox people. And fourth is this Henry Vivian D'Arcio was considered as the first national poet. Even one of his poems is produced in 12th Society book, Bipanchandra itself. This is what contribution of the Young Bengal. So rational thinking and scientific temper is the key part. And next to come to the Brahma Samaj, yes, the pioneer in the social religious reform, especially the Bengal movement, is this Rajaram Mohan Roy of his Brahma Samaj. So what is Brahma Samaj? Is the society of God. That is the meaning of the Brahma Samaj. A Western influenced person, a Western educated person, this Rajaram Mohan Roy wanted to oppose almost all the social negatives, even sometimes evils, as well as the religious negatives or religious evils. Almost. But many an aspirant would again and again, if Brahma Samaj and Rajaram Mohan Roy is asked again and again, they would just confine to Sadi. Wrong. He was in favor of widow remarriage. He was against Sati. He was against dowry. So thus he opposed all the social as well as the religious. He was against idol worship, image worship, polytheism. Right? But ultimately, he is champion of abolition of the Sati because due to his effort, William Bendig government brought abolition of Sati Act. But don't just balloon the sati related matter alone. This alone you can do it in that, because 10 mark you can just write the hint, you can't go for elaboration. Question number 3 is related to the post independence and consolidation. Assess the main administrative issues and socio cultural problem in the integration process of Indian princely states. What shall be the introduction of this at the time of independence? 65% British India, 35% princely states. That is the pure static point, approximately 35% princely states. If you see the princely states, so 65% and 35. In the 35%, how many states is there? Nearly 560 plus states. So these are all pure static information. Any questions related to princely state, invariably you have to write. Okay, then continuation in introduction. This Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, that's a Nehru, Sardar Patel and his team is responsible for integration of the princely states. Right. While integration of the princely states, otherwise you can start. So introduction is over. What are all the different methods they used? You can just note it down. For example, what all the methods? Voluntarily, then plebiscite, then sending army in the case of Kashmir, just on the way. No need to elaborate these things, because maximum 5 lines you can elaborate, then straight away you come to the topic. And next is the sending of army in the case of Hyderabad again. Hyderabad also. So sending of army, that's all. Introduction and related topic is over. And straight away, why integrating is, they faced the following issues. So straight away come to this. So assess the main administrative issues. The question is very specific. You have to write the administrative issues and socio-cultural problem. So what are the administrative issues while integrating it? What is the first administrative issue is how to integrate the princely state with the nearby British Indian territory. That is the biggest issue. Let us take the Hyderabad. Hyderabad is the ever best example. If you take Hyderabad, Hyderabad state is like this. Right? If you see Hyderabad, some of the area Marathi speaking area, some are Telugu speaking area, some of the Kannada speaking area. In which is province you would join? Whether entire Hyderabad would go to Bombay province, otherwise the prevailing Madras province, otherwise would you give it to the Mysore? Already here one kingdom is there, princely state, Mysore state is there. What you would do? So first issue is integrating the princely state with which country? How it is arrived is language. So based on the language, so first administrative, based on language, the integration and consolidation of the princely state with the nearby British Indian territory. This is the first issue faced. And second issue is, in modern India, you would have studied a lot of administrative measures taken by Varanasi, Cornwallis, Wellesley, Dalhousie. Every administrative measures were applicable only to the British Indian territory and not to the princely states. No way it is applicable to the princely states. So at the time of independence, the British India had well-established administration, civil services, irrigation facilities like this, but not in the case of the princely states. So huge administrative lag is there in the case of the princely states. So that to be evolved. For example, what kind of officials, whether to appoint the British Indian officials, otherwise the princely state officials, because here also one officials will be there in princely states. In British India also officials. It's like a merger and acquisition, openly do say. It's a second administrative measure, issues we faced. And third administrative measure is the development in the princely states. Because at the time, some of the princely states were advanced. Many of the princely states are small because of the exploitative nature of the rulers and the monarchy system. Here, complete absence of democracy. So you can write is absence of democracy and democratic. Even democracy is not there in British India also. But by means of 1919-1930, we had at least brought some kind of democratic institutions and the voting. But you can't see here. So teaching the democratic pattern, democratic idea to the princely state is the biggest issues, right? Because their vote bank is very important. And the next administrative issues is when the huge land is taken by the Union of India, their issues, what is the compensation to be given? At last, there is privy purse. Privy purse. So these are all the administrative issues to be looked into that. Right. These are all. And next is socio-cultural problem. What is the socio-cultural problem while integrating? Is again the same thing, language issue. First and socio-cultural problem is language issue, take into that. Best example, the Madras. Here is the Madras province, remaining is the Madras province, but here Hyderabad state is there, here Mysore state is there. Madras province is the ever best example. From that only, from the Madras, Telugu speaking areas and Hyderabad area is given, and Andhra was born, Andhra Pradesh was born, Kannada speaking area given to the Mysore, and Mysore state later become Karnataka. And here Travancore state is there, one more state. Along with that Malayalam speaking Travancore state, the Malabar area of the Madras province is given, and Kerala. So language, socio-cultural, so linguistic related matter. And second is, in British Indian territory, 1920th century, witnessed the socio-religious reformation, what we discussed in the previous question. Witnessed the socio-religious, so women upliftment, abolition of untouchability, likewise upper, but not in the case of princely state. So social reformation, next problem is social reformation is lagging due to that backwardness. Backwardness is the biggest issues. And third is minorities. Minority issue is the biggest in the case of Northeast. So if you go to Northeast, some of the states, while reorganization, everything is clubbed with that Assam. When it is clubbed with Assam, that erupted the problem. That's why you can see the Naga issue, Miso issues, Garo Jainshya. So that led to the minority protection, even sometimes insurgency happened. So in that way, here are 4 to 5, here are 3, then completely given the introduction. In that way, your answer shall be, because this is also one of the biggest, but they ask you to just write the hint point. This can alone be done in 6 to 7 minutes. Next. Question number 11. To what extent? Here question is, to what extent? Many aspirant couldn't lift this word. To what extent did the role of moderates prepare a base for the wider freedom movement? Comment. So if this is the freedom movement base, means to what extent? If 300 kilometer our freedom movement is, to what extent? Only 50 kilometer or only 100 kilometer or entire 300 kilometer this moderates prepare a base? So that's what the question. It means that here you should not completely write moderates alone. No, sir. In the 300 kilometers, first 100 kilometer alone moderates. We have other extent also. Other also work. Extremist put the base. Gandhi put the base. Revolutionary put the base. Swarajist put the base. Subhas put the base. So your answer shall also include these elements also. If you simply write 250 words of moderates, answer is incomplete actually, right? Thus, to what extent is important. So moderates prepare a base. Then what shall be the introduction? 1885 to 1905 is considered in Indian national movement, particularly Congress, the moderates phase or early nationalist phase. Names, Dadabhai Nauruji, Badruddin Diabji, W.C. Banerjee, the leaders. What were the base they prepared? What is the method of struggle? Straight away. What's the method of struggle? they followed a 3P concept. And what is their demand? Just first paragraph, who are moderates? Second paragraph, what is their demand? And what is the method of struggle? Right. Now, straight away, come to the key word of the question. To what extent did the moderates prepare a base? Is straight away come. First is, they were the founding father. They were the founding father of All India movement. Why I am saying is, I never said they are the founding father of national movement. Already nationalism was there. 1857 revolt itself, nationalism is there. Even some of the revolt happened, tribal revolt, peasant revolt happened. But they are in regional level, but here is the All India level. So first thing, they took the national movement into the All India level. All India level. All right. First. Second, how did they enter into All India level? Is if you see the Congress session, they decided to hold the Congress session every year in different parts of India. So they took the nationalism to the different regional level. So now nationalism is brought to the different region. And third is, to what extent moderates prepare a base for wider? Third is, they didn't take social issues. So moderates didn't take social issues because they wanted to include all the people, Hindus, Muslims, Parsis, yeah, all the people, Sikh people were also here. That's why they didn't take social issues. Why? If you take social issues, some people may agree, some may not agree. That's why they didn't take social issue. Why they want wider social base? How could you substantiate your answer? Simple. Take the first four session of Congress and you see the leader of the first four session. Who is the first? W.C. Banerjee, Hindu. Second session, Dadabhai Nauruji, Parsi. Third session, Badruddin Diabji, a Muslim. Fourth, George Yule, a Christian. Over. So wider base. So wider base is there. And the fourth thing is, it is almost they started to link with the British. So these are all the moderates were prepare for the wider freedom movement of this. But it is not without comment. This is a positive notes. But here, to what extent? Here negative is there. What is a negative is, sir, they prepared it for to some extent. Then what is the negative thing? Absence of women. So women participation and leadership is little. So in this, they didn't bring the extent. For example, between 1885 to 1905, considerably one woman, Kadambari Ganguly participated. Apart from that, women in national movement only during the period of Swadeshi movement and the complete participation since the period of Gandhiji. In that sense, it's a lie. Because to what extent? So you can't. This is a negative aspect. And second negative aspect is, these moderates were just confined to educated middle class people. That is a second. So it means that it didn't take it to the rural level. And third, no doubt they expand the social base. But if you see that maximum, it confined to the upper caste group. It was during the extremist period and Gandhiji period, extremist period, middle community, but no middle community in India. And next is lower caste people also involved with the arrival of Gandhiji. So in that, there is absence. And another thing is, if you see the age group is, they are elder people. Just example, Dadabhai Nauruji called as grand old man. So this is a negative aspect. These are all the extent absent. These are all the extent. Right. Then you have to write. Then how these things is solved is with that Swadeshi movement. Because question is not just to moderate. You have to show two paragraph at least. Two paragraphs, each of 4 to 5 lines. With the Swadeshi movement, women participated. With the extremist middle class, lower class started participate. With the Gandhi, all participate. Right. But what is the conclusion? Irrespective of these negatives, it is the moderates founded the foundation, that put the basement strong, over that only all constructed their building. So because of the basement is so strong, from the Congress and national movement, successfully we got independence in 1947. In that way, you have to answer. So normally a student would write positive, only part mark. Some other way, some people would write negative, another part mark. So here a five or six, and other moment also you have to write here the mark 3 to 4 marks. Next question number 12. Bring out the constructive programs of Mahatma Gandhi during non-cooperation movement and civil disobedience movement. The question is very specific. 1922 to 1930. If you take non-cooperation movement 1920, including non-cooperation movement phase, and if you include civil disobedience movement 1934. First, put the time limit and put forward the point that I knew when non-cooperation movement happened, when CDM happened, what is the time between the non-cooperation movement after Chauri Chaura incident and Salt Satyagraha, that is the Dandi March. Here question is, no need to write NCM and CDM. Don't write the programs, functions, so and so. Your question is constructive program, right? This is first. Second thing is straight away. What is the saying? Gandhian phase is based on the concept of STS. This shall be there. Then only the score. So struggle, truce, struggle. What is the struggle phase? Is non-cooperation movement. Then truce. Then struggle phase is civil disobedience movement. Thus, in between is there. So struggle phase, the truce phase is the constructive program. Right? This truce phase alone, 1922 to 1930, is the constructive program. That is what the question. So this timeline shall be there, and the STS method shall be there. Even I can draw the entire STS method like this. For example, if you see Gandhian method, I can draw like this. Whenever this is the active phase, right? Next is the truce. This is the active phase. Next, what would happen? Abrupt end would happen. Right. Again, what happened? Phase, abrupt end. Again, what happened? Like this. So, this is the CDM phase, NCM phase, CDM phase, and Quit India movement. And this is the constructive method. This gap is there. Gradually, and this is the constructive method. So Gandhiji used, why the constructive method? That's a truce. This is a struggle. This dotted is the truce. Right. What is truce phase? Or the truce phase is constructive method. What is used and what is constructive method is preparing the people for next master. That's a key word. Okay, so STS, this, and preparing the people for next to mass struggle, then what are all the constructive phase is one by one is Charkha. Second, village industries, promotion of village industry, that is self-sufficient. Right, the third is abolition of, try to fight against untouchability. Constructive program, untouchability. And Fourth is Atma Sakti, that is that improving the soul power, because Atma Sakti, Rabindranath Tagore used during Swadeshi movement. Here you can use the word soul power, because Gandhi concept is not based on physical power, promoting the people of soul power. Right? So preparing the people are improving their soul power. And next, constructive, five, teaching what is Ahimsa Satyagraha, so that if another movement happened, right, in Ahimsa way, because Gandhiji particularly faced a Chauri Chaura incident. People couldn't understand still Ahimsa and Satyagraha. That's why, so he always insisted the people, what is Ahimsa and what is Satyagraha? Point number 5. And point number 6 is taking the national idea to the common man, so that for next movement, all the people would come. So these are all the constructive programs. That is during which phase? Truce period. What is truce period? Between two struggle periods. Right. Because of this truce, very successful. Right. And if you want to give NCM matters, means during NCM only, he discarded the dress. That is, he discarded the so-called costly dress and just to go with the dhoti. Simplicity during his Madurai visit. And during that civil disobedience movement, again, even he opposed the separate electorate system given to the depressed class and went for fasting. Because Gandhiji wanted to abolish untouchability in different way from Ambedkar. So this is what ultimately, what is the constructive program is, these are all the 6 points to prepare the people for next mass movement. That's why civil, the NCM is not that much success, but the CDM is most success because of this constructive. Okay. This is the core. But only this alone happened during NCM and CDM. You can give broader aspect. One side, Gandhiji went for constructive method, but at the same time, other nationalists went for Swarajist. So you can just mention Swarajist and the youngest group for revolutionary nationalism. So in that way also, your introduction, second paragraph may be there. Question number 13. There arose a serious challenge to the democratic state system between the two world war. Interwar period, 1919 to 1939 is the interwar period. So question is, there arose a serious challenge to the democratic institution. Very easy. What is the question they ask is the rise of fascist idea. And why not? Even Russian Revolution and the rise of dictatorship, rise of communists, even here also challenges to the democratic state system. Right? This is serious. But at the same time, only in some country. So question is, they ask, what is the question they ask is, there are students in between two world war. Many would write only this. Let me tell you. Fascist idea means, normally again would write Italy and Germany. No, you have to write about the Japan. Militarism started to rise in Japan and dictatorship like in Spain because General Franco. So fascism is this. And here is the Russian Revolution. One is Lenin. Lenin wise, mild dictatorship. But if you come to Joseph Stalin, you can see serious challenge to democratic institution. So these things is important. Challenges to this. So this much of things you have to write. But question is not Europe, world. You can repudiate the statement. How could you repudiate the statement? Yes. Only in some country, challenges to democratic. But other countries, especially colonies, it is during the period rise of democratic idea, awakening happened. Best example, India. In India, 1919 Act, some democratic elements were given. 1935 Act, some democratic element. China, in the China only, against the Chiang Kai-shek ideas started to rise. In Kenya, that is African countries. So, right, this element along with the this element, you can't completely substantiate this statement. Normally, a student would write this area alone. Even how far you have written Russian Revolution, I don't know. Even some people, the democratic system means they will just confine to Hitler and Mussolini, but Japan, because in Japan, militarism started to rise. Suppression of democracy, military people in that ministers, right? Military controlled the government, and Spain, Franco, and Joseph Stalin is the totalitarian, right? This is the answer. Now, if you come to the series of danger things, is you have to write the fascist thing. What is the concept of this democratic fascism? Is one leader, one party, one nation. So no opposite party. Opposite party leader were jailed or were killed or diluted. Secret police system. Virtually no election. Our elections were held, one party would get victory. Right? Freedom of speech expression had gone. Here also. Right? Thus, here, this is the answer. If you see the wider perspective, you will at last, these elements, what is the conclusion is, these elements brought the world into the World War II. In that way, your answer shall be there for the 13th question. So this, you split it and write, then you will get an idea. Always for history question, introduction shall be the past and decoding the state. Conclusion shall be the feature. Though this question, 13th question is between two world war, I didn't end with 1939. I didn't stop before 1939. I ended with 1939. Because of this, it took the world into the Second World War. Thank you.
So, hi everyone. Today we'll be discussing the GS1 mains, Indian Society questions, which was asked in 2021 mains. So this year, if we analyze the Indian Society's questions, it is more connected to the current affairs. So for example, Indian Society is connected with other subjects like economy and also science and tech questions. So if we take the example of gig economy question, it is more related to economics. So there was a study conducted by UNDP and FICCI to analyze the relationship or the impact of gig economy on women workforce. So because of this current affair news, this particular question was asked. So there was a question on gig economy's impact on women empowerment. How is gig economy used to empower women? Examining this relationship. And then we also had a question on cryptocurrency's impact on Indian society and also global society. So this we can list it under the syllabus topic of globalization's impact on Indian society. So it is asking for cryptocurrency's impact on Indian society. So totally there was 5 questions from this year's GS1 paper, which came from Indian society subject. So if we see the weightage of the subject, it was, so there were 3 15 marker questions and 2 10 marker questions. So overall, we had 65 marks for Indian society. So now we'll discuss each question. First question is on the tribal society. So apart from the gig economy question and the cryptocurrency question, all other three questions, it was more conventional question only. This tribal question, it was asked in the previous year also. In 2019 mains, there was a question asked on how government is protecting the traditional knowledge systems. So what are the steps taken by government to protect the traditional knowledge systems? That question was asked in 2019 mains in GS2 paper. So in GS2 paper in 2019 mains, there was a question on traditional knowledge systems. So how government is protecting traditional knowledge systems of Indian society? What are all the steps taken by government? So this question was asked in 2019 mains. So using that question also, we can answer this. Question asks us to examine the uniqueness of tribal knowledge system when compared with mainstream knowledge and cultural systems. So we have to compare tribal knowledge system with that of mainstream knowledge system, and we have to give examples also. So this particular question is a 10 marker question. So for 10 marks, we will be allocated 2 pages. So there is 2 page allotted for us to write on this question. Uniqueness of tribal knowledge system, and then comparing that tribal knowledge system with that of the mainstream knowledge system. So this is what the question is asking us. The keyword is examine. So we can write both. We can examine in all the ways. So what can be the introduction for this question? So every question has 3 parts, introduction and body part, and then conclusion. So we can introduce this question by defining the tribal groups. So the basic definition can be your introduction. So introduction, we can use the definition of tribal groups. Tribal groups are social groups who are having common names, common territory, united by a strong kinship bond. So they are having common name. Each tribal group is given a name and they are having common territory. So if we take Todas, they belong to a particular region. And if we take Mankidias, they belong to the Odisha state. So like this, every tribe is going to have a unique territory also. And they are united by a strong kinship bond. So always there is strong kinship relations in tribal groups. So we can define tribal groups, or we can even introduce our questions with the traditional knowledge systems. So we can introduce the government's measures in introduction or else in the conclusion also. Government has brought schemes to protect the traditional knowledge systems. So tribal knowledge system is very unique when compared to the mainstream knowledge system, and it has to be protected. You can give this also as introduction because it is a scheme or policy based introduction. Or you can write the current affairs. So for this question, it is a 10 marker. So a 3-line introduction would be sufficient. So we can just define the tribal groups and then give one or two names for the tribal groups. Now we have to compare the tribal knowledge system with that of the mainstream knowledge system. How can we compare tribal knowledge system with? So first we have to write the side headings, comparison of tribal language, tribal knowledge systems with that of mainstream knowledge systems. So most of the tribal knowledge system, it is about the medicinal knowledge. So if we take the medicines, traditional medicines, Ayurveda, Siddhas, and Yunani, these kind of traditional medical systems, it is using most of the sources from the tribal knowledge. So medical knowledge, we can speak about medical knowledge. We can speak about environment and conservation. So environment conservation. Many tribal groups are involved in environmental conservation activities. So we can discuss about the environmental conservation. And then we can also speak on the life and livelihood of tribals. So it is very different. It is more related with the nature, life and livelihood of tribes. So if we have to give example for these things, life and livelihood, there is a root bridges, living root bridges in Meghalaya. So this Meghalaya tribes, they are involved in making this living root bridges from a rubber tree. So this particular living root bridges, it is analyzed by the foreign countries also. Even Germany has analyzed this particular practice of the tribes to make a environmental friendly infrastructure. So this living root bridges can be replicated in other urban areas also. So there is this the contribution of tribal knowledge system to the mainstream knowledge, it is very huge. So medical knowledge based, there is also a current affair which is speaking about the giloy. So it is a root which is used in the traditional medicines. And recently the Ministry of Ayush, it has accepted for the use of this giloy in traditional medicines. It has said that it has anti-inflammatory property, antimicrobial property. So these kind of medical knowledges, they have traditional medical knowledges, environmental conservations. Most of the tribes they reserve, they are forest dwellers. So forest dwellers, they are in symbiotic relationship with the other biodiversity also. So environmental conservation is the traditional knowledge of the tribal groups. For example, Bishnoi community. So they are involved in the conservation of black bugs. So like this, tribal communities, they are more supporting the environmental conservation. Even we can write about the sacred groves. Sacred groves. So some part of the forests are considered as sacred, and there is no deforestation activities, those kind of felling of trees is not taking place in this particular regions of the forest. It is called as sacred groves. So they have the knowledge system in environmental conservation, medical knowledge, their life and livelihood, their food practices. Even there is a food, tribal food practices are being followed by the mainstream knowledge systems in today's lifestyle. Eating of millets and grains, the traditional food habit of Indian society. It is now re-emerging in the contemporary Indian society. So like this, we can analyze the tribal knowledge system and we have to compare it with the mainstream knowledge system. And all these traditional tribal knowledge system, they are not having any patent. So they are not patented. So these knowledge systems do not have any patent rights. So what the foreign countries are doing is they are stealing or they are using this tribal knowledge systems without their recognition or without having giving their share of profits. So this is happening in the traditional tribal knowledge system. And so we have government have come up with various policy measures. There is Ministry of Ayush to enhance the traditional medical knowledge systems. And there is also another one initiative called as Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. So there is Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. So here our tribal knowledge systems have been recognized and they are codified so that we have the proof that this particular traditional knowledge system is practiced in throughout in Indian history by the tribals. So these kind of initiatives are taken by government to protect these kind of tribal knowledge systems. And because they are not patented and it is very vulnerable to be used by the other corporate companies. So how this is going to be different from that of mainstream knowledge? So in mainstream knowledge, we use scientific explanations to live our lives. But tribals, they use very experience-based lifestyle. So for example, during the pandemic period, when the mainstream society, we used social distancing as a solution, which was derived through scientific knowledge. But tribes in Odisha, they have been practicing this kind of social distancing even when there was epidemics or pandemics during the their earlier historical periods also. So they got their knowledge system based on their experience, and mainstream knowledge system, it is more based on the scientific knowledge. And mainstream knowledge systems are patented, but tribal knowledge systems, there is no patent existing for tribal knowledge system. And so we have to, government should take measures to protect those tribal knowledge systems and cultural systems. So tribal religions is different from compared to the in mainstream religion. In mainstream, we have various kinds of religious faiths followed by the mainstream Indian society. But tribal religion, it is more based on the naturism. So naturism is the tribal religion. So we can differentiate the cultural systems also. Their religion and the family system. Tribals are more egalitarian society when compared to mainstream. In mainstream, we have various kinds of stratifications which are present based on caste system, based on class system, and based on race. So we have different stratifications happening in the mainstream cultural system. But in tribal system, it is more of an egalitarian society. So we can compare tribal and mainstream societies in these aspects. So most important is the environmental conservation and the medical knowledge systems practiced by tribals. You can give each point an example, and the livelihood which is more symbiotic with that of environmental conservation. We can give certain examples and we can discuss how this is different from that of the mainstream knowledge systems. So their religion is different. Their organization of groups are different. So here they are more egalitarian. In tribal society, they are more egalitarian. But in mainstream society, there are various kinds of stratifications present in the mainstream society. So this is how we can differentiate the tribal knowledge systems and the mainstream knowledge systems, and we have to conclude our answer. So in conclusion, we can write that, so tribal knowledge systems is one of the most important asset of Indian society. So government has protected and it has to take steps to protect. So here we can mention the policy measures taken by government to protect these tribal knowledge systems. So we can give the example of traditional knowledge digital library, TKDL. So this is one of the important initiatives by government to protect these non-patented tribal traditional knowledge systems. So this is how we have to answer this question. It is only a 10 marker. Giving examples along with the points will make your answer more better when compared to just listing out the points. Giving examples from the contemporary society, it will be more enhancing your answers. So this is the discussion for the first question. Uniqueness of tribal knowledge system compared with mainstream knowledge and cultural systems. So here the value added points are your examples. So living root bridges, it is used by Germany. Now it is analyzed by Germany to create eco-friendly infrastructure. And we have Giloy. So Giloy is a root which is used in the medicines, and recently Ministry of Ayush has accepted this medicine. So like this, we have to provide examples. So this is about this question. So next question, next 10 marker, it is about gig economy, the process of empowerment of women. So this question, examine the role of gig economy in the process of empowerment of women in India. So why this question was asked is, there was a study conducted by UNDP. So there was a study conducted by UNDP on the impact of gig economy on women workforce. So there is a relationship between gig economy and women workforce. So we can introduce our answer using current affairs, using the definition of gig economy. So introduction wise, we can define gig economy. So how can we define gig economy? Otherwise, we can use current affair also. I'll come to that part of introduction. So after defining gig economy. So gig economy refers to this characterized by, it has the characteristics of the jobs in gig economy is very temporary jobs. It is characterized by temporary jobs. So contract workers, temporary jobs, freelancing. So these kind of jobs will be coming under the gig economy. It is temporary kind of temporary jobs, freelancing, contract works, where long-term employment is not present. So this is how we can define gig economy. So otherwise, we can also use, because during the pandemic, what happened is in women workforce, the female labor force participation rate, it reduced to 20%. During pandemic, female labor force participation rate, it reduced to 20%. So global level, the participation rate of female labor forces, it is around 40%. It is above 40%. But India's female labor force participation rate is only 20%. So here, gig economy would play a major role in women empowerment. We can introduce our question using the current statistics also. Either we can define the gig economy, or else we can use the female labor force participation rate, which is very, it is decreasing in Indian society, and gig economy will play a role in empowering the women section of population. We can introduce our answer using these two types. And then the body part. So I examined the role of gig economy in the process of empowerment of women in India. So we have both the sides. Positives are also there because of gig economy, and there are negative aspects also. So what are all the positive aspects? So gig economy is more of temporary jobs. So there is a flexibility in occupation. We can give, what are all the examples of gig economy is here after definition, you have to give the examples. So example, you can give the platform workers like Uber, Ola. So these kind of platform workers, you can give it as examples, Swiggy. Because of platform workers only, that is the virtual work environment, workspace. It is creating gig economy. So let us discuss the process of gig economy in the process of women empowerment. So first is we have to write in favor of the statement. That is, gig economy is improving the women empowerment. So here we'll be discussing about, since the jobs are more flexible, so flexible jobs. And so women who are also having responsibility to take care of the family, so they have family responsibility also. So they need to take care of the families or the care work they are doing for their families. Along with that, they can take up employment also, paid employment along with the unpaid labor they are doing. So due to the flexibility of the jobs, women can take up the flexible occupations so that they can take care of their house and also their work environment. It will also create women financially independent because women can earn, and so this is going to improve the financial independence of women. So financial independence of women can be improved. And it is in turn going to, due to the flexibility of the job, it is going to improve the female labor force participation rate. So it is improving the female labor force participation rate. And more employment generation is seen. Because of more employment generation, absorption of women into employment can be seen, which were earlier crowded, or it is more favoring the male population. So because of more employment generation and the virtual working space, because we can work from home itself, virtual workplace, that is, work from home is also possible. Work from home is also possible. So this can increase the women's participation in employment opportunities. So work from home is also there, and so it is going to increase the labor participation. Of women. So employment generation is increasing, female labor force participation rate is increasing, and earlier male concentrated jobs. So now even women are entering into the work like food delivery persons and independent musicians. We can see more number of women entering into these kind of occupations. So male concentrated jobs are giving space for women population. So these are all the ways in which gig economy is going to improve the women's position in work environment. It is going to empower women. But we also have certain problems with respect to gig economy and women workforce participation. So gig economy in itself has certain negative aspects because there is no economic stability in gig economy. It is very temporary. So there is no economic stability. So even for women, the lacunas of gig economy and women empowerment. So we have to discuss in this aspect also. So there is no economic stability. So lack of economic stability is going to impact in affecting financial independence of women. So economic stability is an issue. We are also not having social security benefits. So here there is no ensured minimum wages. So minimum wages, there is no ensure, there is no standard minimum wages present in this kind of occupations. And regulation wise, there is no labor laws. The labor codes, which was drafted by Indian government and it is implemented, but it is also included, it is also having gig economy with it, but that particular provision is not getting implemented. So gig economy for now, it is outside the regulation of government. So government regulation is not present. Social security benefits. So these aspects, it is making women more vulnerable only. Without any security benefits, working in this, it is only a temporary job. And there is also a digital divide among the women. So all women are not skilled in Indian society. So there is only school level education for most of the women, because and gross enrollment ratio at the higher secondary level and higher education level, the gross enrollment ratio of India, it is only 20%, around 20%. So here digital divide is also a major issue to access those facilities and for women to participate in those workforce. So digital divide is there. And there is a requirement for skill set of women. So skilled women, skill set of women is obsolete for the gig economy. So we are speaking about Indian women. So there are also lacunas which are restricting the empowerment of women because of gig economy. So this is how we have to discuss both the aspects, and then we can conclude our answer by saying that we need to focus on reskilling the women and also provide accessibility to internet and other technological infrastructure to empower women through gig economy. That way we can conclude our answers. So for these kind of questions, introduce your answer either by definition or by using the current affair aspects, and then discuss about the positives of gig economy in empowering the women. And there are also certain issues present in gig economy which is not going to empower women altogether. So we have to discuss all that problems also, and then we can conclude our answer by providing a way forward. So this is the gig economy in the process of empowerment of women in India, role of gig economy in the process of empowerment of women in India. You can also write that about the UNDP study in your introduction. So you can also write UNDP study in introduction. You can define gig economy, or else you can write about the women labor force participation rate, which is very less in India. And to enhance that, to improve that, gig economy's role is very much needed in empowering Indian women. So this is the discussion for this particular question. So we have completed 2 10-marker question, and then next is 15-marker question. In 15-marker question, only one question is from current affairs. The other 2 questions are most conventional, because in the one question is regarding the population education. So how population education, what are all the objectives of population education, and how it can be achieved? So the next question is, discuss the main objectives of population education and point out the measures to achieve them in India in detail. So how we are going to achieve those objectives of population education. So both, there are 2 parts to the question, main objectives of population education and also the measures to achieve these objectives. So 2 parts of the question, and for a 15 marker, you will be given 3 pages. So first, frame your structure of the answer in your mind and then write the answers. because without framing the structure, without allocating the page division for each of the subheading that you are going to write, you cannot create an entire structure for the answer. So before writing itself, just create the framework of your answer in your mind, and then you can write the answer very effortlessly. So first is, we can define population education. So the basic definition for all kinds of society questions is the definition of population education, the definition of that key topics. So here we can define population education. I'll come to the definition a bit later. Or else you can also introduce your answer speaking about India's population. So we have an estimation that by 2027, India will become the largest populated country. So India will become largest populated country by 2027, surpassing China's population. So there is, this is an estimation. So there is a need for population education in India. You can also introduce your answer in this manner. Or else you can either use this kind of data in your conclusion also. So population education means an educational program. So it is an educational program where study of population phenomenon is where study of population phenomena. So population as a phenomena, the demographic changes, the mortality rates, the birth rates, we are going to study about these things. The study of population phenomena is focused. Population phenomena and demographic variations also you can add. So demographic variations. So this is the definition of population education. You can either define the keyword which is mentioned in the question, or you can provide some statistics. This is, in these ways you can give the introduction for your society answers. And then we have to discuss the objectives of population education. So in India is a very large populated country. And so there is a need for population education to reach the masses about the population's benefits, reduced population's benefits, and huge population is considered as a liability. It is going to put stress on the resources. So we have to reach to the population through population education. So we have to write the objectives of population education. Always give side headings for 15 markers. So objectives of population education. Here we have to reach the people, we have to reach the citizens to take the benefits, to make them aware of the benefits of these small families and less reduced population. The first objective is to make the people aware, to create awareness on the benefits of small families and reduced population. So this is the main objective of the population education, reduced population. We can also introduce this question saying that India is the first country to bring family planning program. So there is a National Family Planning Program 1952. National Family Planning Program. So we also discussed about this family planning program in our foundation course also. So National Family Planning Program 1952. India is the first country in the world to introduce a family planning program for the country. So even this can be your introduction. So now currently we are discussing the objectives of population education. So first thing is to create awareness about the benefits of small families to reduce the population. You can give here example. So example, National Family Program A 1952 has spread the tagline called as V2 Hours 2. So these kind of taglines are used by the government to create awareness among the masses. And the next objective would be, it could be the promote the use of contraceptives and family planning measures. So the objective of population education, the objective of introducing a chapter on the reproduction and contraceptives in school textbooks, it is to educate the population on the usage of these kind of contraceptives and family planning measures. So population control or population policy used this education in school curriculum to make the people aware of the contraceptives and family planning measures. So the second objective would be to promote the use of contraceptives. Contraceptives and family planning measures. So this could be your objective, and to improve the reproductive health of women. So only if we know the ways to control our population, to control the population, birth rates also should be controlled, and also mortality rate should also be controlled. Only if the reproductive health of women is controlled, the mortality rate of children will reduce, and it will in turn reduce the number of children who are born. So increased mortality rate is also an indirect reason for increased fertility rates. More mortality rates, infant mortality rate, if it is high, fertility rates will also be high, because the parents think that if only 5 children are born, at least 2 will survive till their life expectancy. So that is why increased mortality rates will also increase your fertility rates. So reproductive health of women should also be ensured. Reproductive health of women should be ensured. So these are all the objectives of population education policy. So reproductive health should be ensured. Mortality rate should be reduced. Malnutrition and sanitation hygiene should be improved. So sanitation, hygiene, malnutrition. So this will be the objectives of population education, to make people aware of these policy measures, to make people aware of these benefits of having reduced populations. So this is the objectives of population education. So how India is going to achieve these measures, we have to explain in detail, or we have to discuss it in detail. So how these objectives can be achieved by Indian government or India as a society. So we have to discuss about measures to achieve also. Measures to achieve this population education. So what are all the possible ways to achieve these targets or the objectives of population education? So first, there are many ways through creating awareness can be created by using the school curriculum. So they can use school curriculum to introduce the population education in the adolescent stage itself. And we can also have media. Media can play a role in taking these objectives to population, the masses, and to achieve this kind of objectives. Example, Beti Bachao Beti Padhao. This program was hugely led by the media. The campaign of Beti Bachao Beti Padhao, the campaign was led hugely by media only. So we can use media also. So for every point you're writing, write some examples related with the contemporary events which are happening. We can also use the NGOs. So NGOs can be brought in so that these objectives can be achieved. Asha workers, So Anganwadi and Asha workers, midwives, auxiliary midwives, and Anganwadi workers, Asha workers, they can be brought to work as a frontline worker to improve the malnourishment, to improve the nutritional value of the women and children, and also to improve the institutional deliveries. Even now, India's institutional deliveries, it is only around 80%. So, and there is also a population policy. Currently, we are implementing National Population Policy 2000. And this particular policy measures also have to be taken in order to achieve these objectives of population education. So we can write about National Population Policy 2000. So currently, this is the population policy which is under implementation. And then we can give some policy measures which was brought to improve the population. Prerna strategy, it is implemented to reduce population control measure through education. It is an important scheme brought by Indian government, Prerna strategy, to improve the girl children's education in order to control the population. And then it is also ensuring the gap between two pregnancies. So these kind of measures taken by government, Prerna strategy. So Prerna is a scheme brought by government. And now currently there is an amendment brought to, it is about to be brought, the Amendment of Child Marriage Act, which is increasing the legal age to 21. This is also ensuring the education of girl child. So these kind of population measures are also brought. At the end of the answer, we can write government is taking these population measures. And in the end conclusion, we can say that India is going to surpass the China's population by 2027, according to a estimation. So India needs to spread the benefits of having controlled population through population education. You can end your answer using these statistics, using these current affair examples. So I think this is enough to write a 15 marker question. So here and there, give the examples of schemes and give examples of any statistics, quote some policy measures. So that is how you have to enhance your answers. Writing just enumerating points will give you only average marks and not more than average marks. So let us move to the next question. So next question, it is about the cryptocurrency's impact on Indian society and global society. So what is cryptocurrency? How does it affect global society? Has it been affecting Indian society also? So they are asking us that, has it been affecting Indian society? So first part of the question, what is cryptocurrency? Second part of the question, how is it affecting global society? So after the syllabus changed, if we analyze the questions, that is from 2013, impact on global society, it was not asked. So this is, syllabus line is only globalization's impact on Indian society. So if we take the technology as one aspect of globalization, so the analysis of global society itself, this is a new term. This has been asked this year only. How does it affect global society? And then we also have to discuss the impact on Indian society also. So cryptocurrency is not legalized in Indian economy by RBI. So it is not completely legalized by the RBI, our central bank. So has it been affecting Indian society also? So this is the question which is asking us to say about the impact on cryptocurrency on Indian society. So for that, we first have to, this is also a 15 marker. So there will be 3 pages for us to write this particular answer. So first, let us discuss the cryptocurrency's definition. So here we can write the definition of cryptocurrency. So introduction, you can define cryptocurrency. It is a digital currency or it is a virtual currency. So it is a virtual currency. It is not present in its physical form. So it is a virtual currency which is protected by cryptography. Cryptography, the encryption, decryption. So it is a virtual currency which is protected by cryptography and acts as a medium of exchange. Even this cryptocurrency is acting as a medium of exchange. So it is also a medium of exchange and it uses blockchain technology based on blockchain technology. So this can be your introduction. You can introduce cryptocurrency using its definition. And you can also mention certain features of cryptocurrency, because the question, there is a separate question asking about what is cryptocurrency. So obviously you need to introduce your answer by defining cryptocurrency only. Then we can also speak about its features. That is, it has a decentralized ledger. So I think you would have studied about cryptocurrency, its technology in science and tech. So decentralized ledger. That is, there is no centralized authority to regulate this currency. It is a decentralized currency. So it has a decentralized ledger and there is anonymity present in the ownership of these cryptocurrencies. So the government will not know who is going to own this particular currency. So there is anonymity present in this cryptocurrency. And also it is volatile. Since there is no regulation, it is purely based on the market forces. So it is also volatile. So these can be certain features of cryptocurrency. And then we can discuss about its effect on global society. If you want, I think this is enough for a society's answer. We are in the society answer, we are speaking about cryptocurrency. If it is a science and tech question, you can write about more in length and breadth about cryptocurrency. But here we should keep it short on the part, what is cryptocurrency? And then we should move on to its effect on global society. So it is affecting global society also, and also Indian society. So each should be allocated. So there should be discuss on global societies, cryptocurrency's impact on global society and also cryptocurrency's impact on Indian society. So on global society, so if we see there is an impact on global society, like many countries and many corporate organizations, big tech companies are also introducing new cryptocurrencies. Here we have to give certain examples. So Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency. Libra is a big cryptocurrency. We also have Petro as a big cryptocurrency. So certain examples we should give. So many countries are also giving, they are generating their own cryptocurrencies, which are pegged to some other. They are having certain backup. For example, Facebook has introduced Libra as its cryptocurrency. So Libra is a cryptocurrency. And Venezuela country, it has created a cryptocurrency for its usage, the country's usage. It is Petro. So these kind of cryptocurrencies are created by the countries and corporate organizations also. So global society's impact, we can say that most of the countries, in order to tame the inflation of their hard currency, or the fiat currencies of their country, they are more relying on this cryptocurrency. And also there is economic integration. So economic integration happening at global level. So this is an important impact of cryptocurrency on global society. So cryptocurrency, the Bitcoin, it is used by all the countries and there is no any central authority which is regulating this particular currency. And so it is purely based on the market forces. So if you take the dollar, American dollar, it is controlled by the American government. So there is a central authority which is regulating that currency. But for a cryptocurrency, we do not have any regulating authority. So it is also integrating the economy of the whole world without any central authority. So there is economic integration at global level. And it is also affecting the sovereignty of the state altogether. So here, that is one of the reasons why India's RBI is not legalizing the cryptocurrencies. So sovereignty of state sovereign power to regulate currency is affected. Power to regulate currency is affected. Since it is a decentralized technology, states is reducing the power of state to regulate the currencies. See, if there is a huge influx of other countries' currency or the physical currency in Indian society, RBI can make some operations. That is, it can absorb the money, increasing the repo rates and reverse repo rates. So these kind of regulating operations cannot be done by the states. So if state is losing the sovereignty in order to control the money supply in the market. So this is how it is impacting the global society. And also we can say terror financing is increasing. It will increase terror financing because of the anonymity which is present with the cryptocurrency. We do not know the owner of that particular currency. So it is increasing the terror financing and also money laundering. So these kind of impacts we have on global society. So how is it impacting Indian society? So before writing the impact on Indian society, we have to mention that RBI has not yet legalized the trade of, has not legalized the trade of cryptocurrency. However, Supreme Court also, RBI banned the cryptocurrency trade initially, and then Supreme Court banned that, it did not upheld the ban on cryptocurrencies. So that particular order of RBI, it was withheld by the Supreme Court. So because of that, there is cryptocurrency investors. So increase in cryptocurrency investors is seen in Indian society. Investors were also increasing. And cryptocurrency exchanges were also increasing. So if we open any YouTube or any kind of social media, there were more advertisements for the cryptocurrency exchanges. So trade in cryptocurrency increased in Indian society even when the RBI did not legalize the trade of cryptocurrency. And so there was cryptocurrency exchanges and cryptocurrency investors were increasing. And important other current affair is there was ransomware attacks. So ransomware attacks happened in India demanding cryptocurrencies. So government websites were hijacked by the hackers and they demanded for cryptocurrency to open that particular website. So ransomware attacks happened in Indian society. So these kind of events happened because of cryptocurrency in Indian society. So there is an impact of cryptocurrency in Indian society, but it is the cryptocurrency's usage in Indian society is in a very nascent stage. So it is only in very nascent stage. And so it should be regulated in the earlier stages itself in order to restrict the negative impacts of cryptocurrencies. So this is how we can analyze this particular question. So what is cryptocurrency is one part, and global society, how it is getting impacted because of cryptocurrency, and Indian society's impact on Indian society's impact because of cryptocurrency. So all these parts we have addressed, and so we have to conclude that Indian society, the cryptocurrency is only in a very nascent stage, and so it should be regulated, or we can use the technology behind this cryptocurrency. The blockchain technology can be used very efficiently, as said by RBI. So this is how we can conclude this particular question. So next is the last question. It is a very easy question, and it was a very conventional question also. So let us discuss the next question and the last question. How does Indian society maintain continuity in traditional social values? How it is maintaining continuity in traditional social values? And also we should enumerate the changes taking place in the traditional social values. In this manner, we have to write this particular question. So it is asking about the traditional social values which are continued in Indian society. Along with that, the changes also has to be enumerated. Enumeration means listing out with examples. So what are all the changes that are happening in Indian society? We have to discuss. So first, introduction. How can we introduce this particular question? Indian society maintains continuity in social values, and also there are changes. So Indian society is having both tradition and also modern aspects. It has the coexistence of traditional and modernity. So in one of the salient features of Indian society is coexistence of tradition and modernity. So in India, we have both tradition and also modern aspects. So there is a coexistence of tradition and modernity. But the question is asking about how is this traditional aspects maintained in Indian society? How this is maintained? How this is taken forward to other generations? How the traditional social values of Indian society is taken forward? So what are all the traditional social values? We can just list out, because it is not asking about traditional social values. It is asking about how these social values are maintained in Indian society. So before that, we can write about certain traditional social values. We can write about Vasudeva Kutumbakam. It is one of the traditional social values. That is, whole world is considered as one family. Vasudeva Kutumbakam. We can write that. And we can write the unity in diversity. So multiculturalism. Even from ancient Indian society, we have many kinds of religion, many cultures present in our society. So multiculturalism is also a traditional value. Tolerance. And religion. Joint family system. So we can write certain traditional social values. And then we can discuss how these are maintained in India. So how this is maintained. So here we can give the side heading as maintenance of traditional social values or continuity in traditional social values. So we can discuss about the flexible aspect of India. When Britishers came in, or when the Islamic invasions happened into Indian society, Indian society altered itself to the changes that were happening in because of the invasions of other external factors. So here we can write that flexibility and adaptable capacity of India. So flexibility and adaptable capacity. Adaptation, adaptable capacity of India. You can write the examples of Islamic invasion or the Britishers. Even when these invasions and British rule happened in India. India maintained their its traditional social values only because it is flexible, and so it adapted to the changes, and also it maintained the traditional value systems. And because of the tolerance level of India also, so it had tolerance level towards other cultures. Though there were conflicts, but there was more tolerance when compared to the cultural xenophobia, the fear of other cultures. So India accepted the other cultures also, and it also retained its traditional social values. So tolerance is an important aspect which has to be discussed as a factor in maintenance of continuity in Indian social, traditional social values. And then we can also say integration of cultures also happened. So integration of cultures. Even when other cultures like British culture brought the Western social values into India, but there was no assimilation of culture, there was only integration of cultures. India also maintained its traditional values, and also it accepted the Western values also. For example, certain social evils, that is socio-religious reform movements. We can give the socio-religious reform movements as examples, where social evils were abolished by the more rational ideology. At the same time, traditional values were retained. So even now, India is giving more importance to its family system, giving more importance to the religious values and all the cultural values and festivals of India. So these kind of traditional values are even respected in today's society. But at the same time, there is also impact of other cultures also. So we are integrating the new cultures into our culture. Also, we can speak about globalization. So though there is globalization is also present. That is, Western values, Western concepts, when they are introduced into Indian society, they are customized on the basis of Indian values. Localization. That is, we can also say it like Indian culture is also impacting the Western ideologies, Western cultures. Example, we can give the International Day of Yoga, International Yoga Day. So yoga is an Indian culture, but it has been celebrated at an international level. So International Yoga Day is an example of globalization. So this is how we are having, or we are continuing the traditional social values because of the flexibility of Indian society, the tolerance level that Indian population is maintaining. Here we can give the examples of ancient India, British India, and even in contemporary globalized society, there is only integration of cultures. We are not assimilating into one culture. We are just integrating with other cultures. Example, social religious reform movements. Though your Rajaram Mohan Roy, he is called as the Renaissance man of India, he adopted only certain practices of Western society. But the traditional values is also continued. That is, he also supported Vedas. Only he was opposing the traditional aspect. I mean, he was opposing the superstitious beliefs present in Indian value system. Otherwise, he also supported India's value only. Even the national movement, there was a glorification of India's past. So we are integration, we are practicing integration of cultures more. And there is also globalization, which is a phenomena that is Indian values is also impacting the global values. So traditional values is also retained during the era of globalization also. And the question's other part is asking us to enumerate the changes taking place in the social values. Here we can speak about changes which are happening because of structural changes are also there and cultural changes are also there. So here we can divide this part, the changes that are taking place in value systems, social values. So here we can bring in the structural changes and then cultural changes also. The next part of question. structural changes. And also we have to discuss about cultural changes. So under cultural changes, hybridization, we can discuss. That is the example of aloo tikki burger. So McDonald's selling aloo tikki burger, it is an example of hybridization. So homogenization of culture is also happening at certain places, like food habits, dressing style, English language. So there is homogenization, hybridization also. At the same time, traditional aspects are also retained. So here change is happening. We can discuss the hybridization and homogenization and give certain examples on the basis of cultural changes. Structural changes, what are all the changes happening in family? So now the nuclearization of families. Nuclear families are getting created. So families, nuclear families are formed. And various other new types of families are created because of globalization. So new types of families like single parent family, women headed family. So we can discuss the structural aspects. Several types of families have formed. Women headed families and cohabitation families, that is living relations, cohabitation families. So structural wise, families are having these changes, and functions of families are also changing. So the interpersonal relationships and the marital relationships today. Today, Indian marriages are more based on the compatibility, and marriages are not considered as sacred today. So these are the changes happening in the institution of marriage. So family, marriage. Marriage is more on the compatibility side. So compatibility of individuals is seen as the factor that is leading to marriage, not the traditional marriage, like marriages are made in heaven. It is very sacred. So these kind of notions have been changing, and compatibility based marriages are increasing, and even the caste system is changing. The value of untouchability is changing. Occupations based on marriages, it is not the same today. Occupation based on your caste. Now we have flexible occupations. So these are some of the changes. Family, marriage, caste, and also interpersonal relationships. That is, individualism is increasing. So we have to discuss certain changes. And also we can say that women, children, old age, all the sections of population, how there is value changes. Women today are more engaging in the economic participation. Old age people, they are more suffering from the isolation, and because of lack of family care that was available to them in the traditional family system. So these are the changes. But now the old age care is given to, or it has been the function of old age care institutions, old age institutions. So now this care has been institutionalized. Families are no longer acting as the, or it is not performing the functions of taking care of old age population. So these are some of the changes. And then we can conclude our answer by saying that though there are changes to the value systems, traditional value system is also retained. So here we can say there is coexistence between tradition and also modernity. So that is how we can end this particular question. So I think this year society questions are more easier when compared to last year. And because of inclusion of world history and post-independence question, society one or two questions has been reduced. Last year there were 6 questions. This year there was only 5 questions. But this is also an important subject. So even in GS2 paper in social justice, there were certain questions which were more trickier when compared to last year. So we'll also discuss the GS2 social justice paper. So thank you guys.